Well, good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to call this meeting of the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality to order. Today is Wednesday, March 30th, 2022. The time is 9:30 a.m. With us today are Commissioners Emily Lindley and Bobby Janeka, as well as our General Counsel, Mary Smith, and I'm John Neerman. For those of you who are joining us virtually, please keep your microphones muted when you're not speaking. And for those who are making presentations, please wait to begin your presentation until I or our General Counsel have asked you to begin speaking. On items where argument or discussion is allowed, we will inform speakers of their time limits. Registration has now closed, but if you'd like to address the commission on a particular item, please email agenda@tceq.texas.gov with your name, affiliation, and the item you'd like to comment on, and we will do our best to accommodate that request. And with that, I'd like to thank everyone for being present, and Ms. Smith, I'll ask you to please call the first item.
Item number one is the application by Max Midstream Texas LLC for air quality permit number 162941. The parties have been notified that the commission will not take oral argument but may ask questions.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. For the benefit of those who are not familiar with our process on contested case hearing requests, we have a two-part analysis. First, we consider whether the requesters have met the procedural and substantive requirements to be entitled to a contested case. And assuming that at least one requester has met those requirements, we then consider which issues are appropriate to refer for hearing. So part one is about who gets a hearing, and part two is about which issues are referred. Requesters who are affected in a manner different from the general public and who have articulated personal concerns that are relevant and material to the permit and have done so both in timely comments and a timely hearing request are entitled to a hearing. Associations may be granted a hearing if the interests expressed are germane to the organization's purpose and the association identifies at least one person, one member by name and address who would have standing in their own right. And in determining affected persons, we consider the requester's statement of their personal concerns as well as their proximity to the regulated activity together with the nature of the authorized emissions. And colleagues, on this item, we have well over 2,000 requests. The vast majority of those are similar form letters, none of which are from persons who articulated a personal concern. The concerns expressed in those letters are only generalized. And in addition, none reside close enough to have an interest different from the general public. Many are from out of state. I think the closest one is about 16 miles away. So we're compelled to deny the request in those form letters. Next, we have several requests filed by the Environmental Integrity Project, and the first is for Diane Wilson. Although Ms. Wilson resides about 15 miles from the facility, she states that she swims and kayaks in Matagorda Bay and that she visits outfalls near the facility, and that includes weekly visits to outfalls that are 3 to 5 miles away and less frequent visits to outfalls that are approximately 1,300 and 3,100 feet from the facility. On Ms. Wilson, I agree with the executive director and the Office of Public Interest Counsel that these infrequent visits are not sufficient to establish a personal justiciable interest. So I would deny Ms. Wilson's request. EIP also filed requests for the San Antonio Bay Estuarine Waterkeeper and the Texas Campaign for the Environment. And for standing purposes, they cite the following members of those groups: Mauricio Blanco, Dale Jurasek, John and Janet Marish, Curtis Miller, and once again, Diane Wilson. Mr. Blanco resides roughly 6 miles from the facility and makes a living shrimping and oystering in Matagorda and Lavaca Bays. He states that he fishes in Cox Bay, which is between 1.38 and 2.32 miles of the facility. And given the nature of the proposed air emissions and the distance of his activities, Mr. Blanco, in my view, does not establish an interest different from the general public. So he would not have standing in his own right. Mr. Jurasek resides roughly 5 miles from the facility At that distance, he would not be affected in a manner different from the general public, so he does not have standing in his own right. John and Janet Marish allege recreational interests in the area, but they don't address the frequency or proximity, so those allegations do not support standing. They also reside about 1¾ miles from the facility, which, colleagues, in my view, that's a closer call, but it's still not a close call. And I say that because this is a Clean Air Act minor source authorization. The modeled concentrations of air contaminants at the fence line are well below the national ambient air quality standards and below our conservative effect screening levels. So in my view, the Marishes have not established standing. Curtis Miller is a commercial fisherman who fishes recreationally at Mitchell's Reef. His business is located approximately 4.8 miles from the facility, and Mitchell's Reef is about 2 miles away. And much of Mr. Miller's comments and concerns are about water quality, which are outside our jurisdiction on this application. We can't consider those. As for the air emissions, at the distances that are stated, and given the nature of the facility's emissions, I can't see that Mr. Miller is affected in a manner different from the general public. So in my view, Mr. Curtis is not established standing. So taken together, it's my view that the persons that were cited to establish associational standing, these members, none of them have standing in their own right. So we're compelled to deny the requests by San Antonio Bay Estuarine Water Keeper and the Texas Campaign for the Environment. The Environmental Integrity Project and the Texas Rio Grande Legal Aid also identify themselves as hearing requesters, but neither identify a member who has standing in their own right. So we can't grant their requests either. And Commissioner Lindley, I think I've addressed all the parties. What do you think?
I believe you have, and I'm in agreement that I would also deny all the hearing requests.
Commissioner Janeka.
I too am in agreement. I wanted to return back to one point and just revisit it and clarify what I think you very helpfully alluded to throughout the discussion of all of the requesting parties. I think that it's worth stating here, although it's been argued by the applicant in this matter, I want to make clear that the commission has not created a 1 mile standard to determine effectiveness. The affected person status of a hearing requester is based on the factors established in our rules, and it involves a fact-specific evaluation of the permit, including the type and volume of emissions that is used to determine the likely impact the facility will have on a specific requester that's not common to the general public. And as you stated, and which I agree with, the executive director appropriately classified this facility as a minor source. I do believe that standard has been clearly met here. None of the requesters do meet that, rise to that level of affected person.
Thank you, Commissioner Janeka. I agree with that.
Mm-hmm. Excellent point.
Any other thoughts or comments on this item?
No.
If not, I think we're ready for a motion.
I have a motion. I would move that we deny all hearing requests, that we issue air quality permit number 162941 to Max Midstream Texas LLC as recommended by the executive director, and adopt the executive director's response to comments.
I second.
The motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. The motion carries. Ms. Smith, please call the next items.
That takes us to our enforcement docket, items 2 through 18. The executive director's staff is here to present these matters.
Good morning.
Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners, General Counsel, and Public Interest Counsel.
For the record, my name is Melissa Cordell of the Enforcement Division, and with me today are Susan Jablonski, also of the Enforcement Division, and Gitanjali Yadav of the Litigation Division, representing the Executive Director. Pending before you are items 2 through 18. The total assessed administrative penalties are $1,021,963, with $98,360 deferred, $391,975 applied toward supplemental environmental projects, and $531,628 to the general revenue. We respectfully request approval of these items and are available to answer any questions you may have.
I don't have any at this point. Commissioner Lindley, any questions?
No, thank you.
Commissioner Janeka. All right. We do have quite a few interested persons signed in wishing to speak, and Ms. Smith, I'll just ask you to take those one at a time.
Okay, well, I'll begin with item 7. We have people signed in on 7, 10, and 11, so begin with 7. On 10, it's somebody who is available for questions but hasn't asked to address the commission. So first we'll call Ms. Abby Lumen.
Ms. Lumen, are you, okay, I think we hear you. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I'll try to go quick. Thank you for allowing me to address the commission. I'm concerned with the ongoing lost use of my property and the impacts of the constant bypassings on my home, property, animal, and wildlife. 26 bypasses in 1 month is unacceptable and a huge health risk. With the bypasses, I have suffered allergic reactions leading to 30% decreased air intake from the repeated inflammation with no healing time between the bypasses. The excessive bypassing has caused me to become asthmatic. I've incurred nosebleeds, instant rashes, face, neck, welts, headaches. I have to leave my home for days to get relief during and after the bypasses. This has resulted in limited use of my time outdoors doing the things I love and retire to do. I'm concerned that our air quality meter shows poor quality, that no one is being held responsible for their actions of forcing the neighbors to breathe chemicals. I'm concerned that our sound meter readings have been between 75 and 80 at times near my sleeping area. This is resulting in the loss of sleep. Woodville pellets has made this part of my life now, sleep deprivation. The noise pollution alone is horrible, constant, intrusive, and high-pitched clanging sounds 24 hours a day for extended periods of time. I have concerns for the last 3 years over the filter that would reduce the amount of harmful emissions being emitted, not being installed. First, it was delayed, then extensions were granted. Now the filter, we were told at a public meeting last week, is on time to be scheduled March of 2022. But at this point, they do have an option for extensions again. Last in closing, I have additional concerns with the periods after Woodville Pellets purchased the facility in June 2019, and they let the Title V operating permit run out September 2020. They have continued to operate now for 1.5 years to date without a Title V permit. They continue to operate with no regards for public safety. Data from Enviva, the largest pellet mill in the world, shows numerous comparable stack testing that Woodville Pellet emits 83 tons of methanol, 21 tons of acetylene, 14 tons of formaldehyde, all in a year. They have exceeded limits of 10 tons a year. Permits were put in place to protect. The absence of the Title V means you cannot operate. We, the concerned citizens, have lost our quality of life and the freedom to enjoy our property due to the negligence of Grinnell Investments, a.k.a. Woodville Pellets. Woodville Pellets should be issued an injunction to cease operation with no current permit if the install of the permit is not completed, as an incentive to encourage standard safety requirements that they have not been willing to implement. Woodville Pellets has shown they have no regards to human life, property, animals, or wildlife. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Lumen. Sorry to hear about the health conditions that you're suffering. We did receive your written comments as well, so I wanted to thank you for those also. Colleagues, any questions?
Thank you.
Any questions or comments for Ms. Lumen? Okay. Ms. Smith, go ahead.
I did have a question for ED regarding Ms. Lumen's comments, so this may be an appropriate time to ask those.
Sure.
Thank you. I just wanted to turn to ED staff. I was concerned reading those allegations of health impacts and Ms. Lumen's comments, and I noted the timing of when those comments were received. I just wanted to ask, was the ED aware of those allegations when considering this matter before us?
Commissioner
Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners. I'm Susan Jablonski with the Enforcement Division. And so, yes, we were aware of ongoing complaints and have been working with the region. They're actually available on the line if you have specific questions for them of conditions at the site at this time.
I appreciate that response, Mr. Jablonski. So I'll ask you, and perhaps the region staff may chime in. Were you aware if you were aware of these specific health allegations from Ms. Lumen, were those specific allegations considered in this matter before us today? And if not, is that something that you're currently investigating further?
So as far as this current allegation, they were considered in a general respect from the comments and the complaints that had come in as part of this case in the past. But as far as these current complaints that she has, I think it would be better for the region to address how they're handling those currently and if there's a potential for cases coming to us in the future. So we've got Sarah Kirksey on the line, if you'd like to hear from her from the region.
Thank you. If you have anything to add, Ms. Kirksey, I'd appreciate it.
Absolutely. Good morning. For the record, my name is Sarah Kirksey, and I am in the Region 10 Beaumont office. The region has and will continue to investigate complaints of nuisance conditions. Up to this point, a nuisance condition has not been documented at the complainant's property.
All right. Thank you. I appreciate that. And I note that the allegation of health impacts appears to be the real material separating factor between whether a violation under these rules can be found to be moderate or a major violation. And I understand that's a very difficult point to prove up going down the road to enforcement and making stick those major violations. So I take very seriously these allegations, but I very much appreciate the limitations that ED has in collecting sufficient evidence that go to these effects. So I just wanted to make sure I was aware of any limitations or discussion y'all are working in this space. So I very much appreciate these answers. Thanks.
Well, I was going to save my thoughts for a little bit later, but since you've teed it up, let me dive in. I had similar concerns really based on Mr. Stafford's comments. The way that I read Ms. Lumen's comments is that a lot of them relate to issues that are alleged to have happened after the date of the violations before us here. So, I think we need to consider those separate from these, but you helped make my point. You started to make the point, which is how do you square complaints about health effects from violations at the facility with the executive director's comment in the backup material or the response to comments that that the respondent made a demonstration that there were no health effects. And I didn't see any information in the backup material to describe what that demonstration was. And so, colleagues, my suggestion, just to cut to the chase here, is that we continue this item to give the executive director the opportunity to put into the backup material an explanation of what that demonstration was. You know, I'm trying to square our agency's negotiations and views with the allegations that we're hearing from the commenters. And so I think we need to drill down on this, get more information, and really it's appropriate for us to show our work here. Let me pause there. I have some additional thoughts, but let's get, and I welcome your thoughts and comments, but I do want to hear from the other interested.
I was just going to say I'd love to hear from the rest of the interested persons as well, and then we can talk about, you know, what you've potentially proposed or not.
Great.
Likewise, I appreciate your thoughts now, and let's return to the questions.
Okay. Ms. Lumen, thank you again. Ms. Smith, please call the next person.
The next person on the list is Mr. Dustin Stafford.
Good morning, Mr. Stafford.
Good morning.
Go ahead when you're ready, sir.
Hi. I just want to really talk about, it feels like y'all don't really know what's been going on, or y'all haven't been given everything that's been going on. This has been a horrific issue for the last 3 years. I've came on first base name with Ms. Kirksey. It feels like I work for TEQC, and that's really unfair. It feels like everybody says that you guys in Austin started this adventure. Y'all issued these permits, and I think y'all got it wrong from the beginning. Y'all didn't get how close residential homes were, how close businesses were, and it really feels like we're fighting an uphill battle. This facility demonstrates that they're really about profit over people, and I feel like money just gets exchanged and extensions get filed, and nothing happens. My experience the last 3 years, I have a son that has issues with the air quality. I only get him first, third, fifth weekends, and it's a shame that he can't enjoy his property with me. I'm a fourth generation. I'd like to leave my property to my son. I can't sell my property because nobody wants to live near a place that causes them harm, causes them health effects. I think that's really unfair. Financially, I'm disabled, and you know, I have some physical issues, but I like to have good air quality, and I think I deserve good air quality. I have livestock, chickens in instance. I've lost more chickens in the last 3 years from upper respiratory issues. I've lost a really close dog. Other neighbors have experienced this. We've experienced random nosebleeds, nose running, scratchy throats. It's like you have allergies year-round. And we live in Southeast Texas, and you know Texas has pollen, but nothing blooms in the winter. I've reached out to TQC many, many times, and it seems like all they do is follow the extension. And this company has the money to put in the filter, and I fear that this is what's going to happen again. 18 months ago, y'all had the option to make them put the filter in, and y'all granted an extension. Please stop granting extensions. Either put the filter in or cease operation. $100,000 or $100 million a year is enough money to take care of this. Profit over people is not how we should operate, and we shouldn't, you know, treat people. It's unfair. I don't want to have premature death. Some of the stuff that I'm breathing is not fair. I invite any of you guys to come down and experience what I experienced, 75 to 80 decimeters at night. You can't sleep half the time. It's sporadic work schedule. And you never know when you're going to be bypassed on. I have to leave my property, and I get better air quality sometimes in Houston. I have a monitor at my house. Y'all are welcome to look at it, purple air monitor. And you can see the charts and the stats. It's scary, and it's not right. And I want you guys to really look at this.
Mr. Stafford, thank you. Appreciate your testimony this morning and your written comments. Colleagues, do you have anything for Mr. Stafford?
No, appreciate you calling in.
I just want to grab one item from what he said that I really appreciated hearing. He said it feels like he works for TCQ, and that's really unfair. And I think I have to just acknowledge that and say I agree. I appreciate your taking on that burden, but like so many of your other Texans, when you have facilities come in and work in your backyard or your vicinity or neighborhood, our agency really asks for and welcomes and invites and relies upon citizen input and complaints and watching and helping us report and hold accountable the facilities in the vicinity. And so it is exactly that. And I apologize that you have to step up and fill that role, but we really count on and continue to need you and other Texans like you doing that role. So I just appreciate that point.
Thank you, Commissioner. Ms. Smith, please call the next person.
Ms. Mary Kate Flanagan.
Good morning, Ms. Flanagan. And we are not hearing you, so you might check your mute button.
There, can you hear me now?
We got you now, yes. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you. This was a hurry up and get it together type thing, but it is that I didn't know about the meeting until a couple of weeks ago and what it involved and trying to get in touch with the TCEQ people in Austin to arrange that I could be here. I came to Woodville in November of 2019 and immediately did not feel well. I thought I was moving to the country where the air is clean and the water is sweet, and that has not been my experience. I immediately experienced allergic reactions, nosebleeds. I was not able to stay outside. I had a chronic cough. I was easily fatigued, and I was in pretty good shape. I didn't know what it was until I went to a community meeting, and then I found out that there were other concerned citizens about the pellet plant and the emissions, the carcinogenic emissions that are coming from the plant, the tons of VOCs that are being released, the methanol, the acrolein, and so forth. I've talked to the neighbors then. I talked to TCEQ several times. What's going on with this? And they're willing to take my comments. Your agency is willing to take comments. But what I have seen after being there, living here for over 2 years, is that nothing has been done. As has been stated before, there have been extensions. There have been a lot of comments. We're willing to take comments. We have those things are documented. But there is no data that is released to the public from the plant saying that this is how much, this is what's being released. There is no reporting to say that anything is being done to stop the polluting of our air, our quality of life. There's no documentation and, frankly, no transparency. It's all very, it's a one-way mirror where we are giving our information and nothing is given in return. I was part of a lawsuit in federal court, and we had a consent decree from the federal judge, and again, nothing was done. It was extensions that went on for 6 months. It's been over 6 months now, and nothing is done. I'm in my home. Visitors come. They get sick. Visitors won't come. Visitors, meaning my daughter and my grandchildren, won't come and visit me anymore. So I compiled my own data. I was looking at the meteorology, the weather, where it's coming from, how the wind is blowing. And I had also my own monitor and the meter at my home. So I had to correlate my own data because I could not get any data from any government agency, any state of Texas agency.
Ms. Flanagan, go ahead.
That's a nuisance complaint. It's more than a nuisance. There's no quality of life. I do not want to be chronically sick, and I do not want to get cancer or a death sentence because of this plant. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Flanagan. Just in response to your comments, I want to mention just a couple of things. We do have a network of stationary air quality monitors across the state. I'm not sure exactly where those monitors may be in relation to your residence, but there's information available online, open to the public. Much of it is real time. I will confess that it is difficult to use. We have a project ongoing right now to make it easier to use. If you need assistance with it, I think we can find somebody at the agency to help you navigate that database so you can see the air quality monitoring data at the monitor close to your house. We also require permittees to report their emission events to the agency. That's done online. There's a database with that information also. It is not a simple matter for a layperson to look it up, but once you figure that out, that's available to you too. So there is a way to track the reporting that this entity does to the agency. So what I'm saying is that there are solutions. They're imperfect. We're trying to make them better. But I just wanted to address those two comments. Colleagues, any questions or comments for Ms. Flanagan?
No, thank you.
No, thank you for the comment.
Ms. Smith, please call the next person.
Ms. Amy Den.
Good morning, Ms. Den.
Good morning. This is Amy Den, the Environmental Justice Managing Attorney at Lone Star Legal Aid. Lone Star Legal Aid has been working with residents in Woodville since 2018 to address the issues with the Woodville pellets plant, which has exceeded its volatile organic compound emissions permitted from inception of operation. To speak to the air monitoring comment really quick, there is no air monitor in Tyler County. We've submitted comments to TCEQ in connection with the air monitoring network plan and highlighted the issues that these residents are having with the facility ongoing and the out of compliance nature that this facility has been in since started operations, which is well documented with the TCEQ. Our current client, Mr. Stafford, and his mother, Abby Lumen, have had severe impacts on their property because of the operations of the facility. In addition to Mrs. Kate and other community members that we have met with TCQ present at community meetings to hear the complaints from community members. We had to file a citizen suit with Sierra Club to address the concerns when the agency failed to act and instead chose to grant extensions to the facility to install controls that were needed to bring the facility within its permanent limits. Then during the pendency of that lawsuit, the plant failed to renew its Title V permit and still currently lacks a Title V permit, yet it's allowed to continue operating in excess of its permitted limits. While this administrative order is a good step in enforcement, it's not going far enough because the administrative order does not address the continual bypass events at the facility, where the facility is simply bypassing and putting harmful pollutants into the air to the detriment of the neighbors within 1 mile of the facility, like my client, Mr. Stafford. These events are regularly reported to the agency. The health impacts are regularly reported to the agency, and these health impacts are not reflected in this administrative order. Further, there are emissions from other sources like the green hammer mills at the facility that this order does not even come close to addressing. Thankfully, there's a consent decree that was entered by the federal court in January of 22 as a result of the citizen suit efforts that will address some of the issues at the facility. But it has taken too long for this action from the agency. It's hard to understand why the agency will allow this facility to continue to operate in violation of its permit limits without controls and without a Title V permit. It's hard to explain that to my client and the other residents of Woodville why they have to continue to endure these bypasses weekly when no other facility in Texas, I hope, would be able to act in such dereliction of its permit. And while the agency has made an exception here, it's why that is not clear. We certainly,
go ahead and finish up, Ms. Dinn.
We certainly hope this remains the exception and that we can have a commitment from both the operator and the agency after these controls covered by the administrative order installed in May to continue to ensure that reports of issues at the facility are investigated, taken seriously, and penalized under the 2020 penalty policy if needed, including a thorough review of the nuisance conditions generated by this facility that have been raised by the concerned citizens that have taken the time to speak today. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Ms. Dinn. I do have a question for you. Do you know anything about the demonstration that the respondent made to TCEQ that would purportedly shows that the VOC uncontrolled VOCs did not exceed levels that are protective of human health or environmental receptors, or did you learn about that for the first time in the response to comments? I'm just wondering what you know about that.
Well, what we do know is that this facility was originally permitted for 58 tons per year of VOCs, and the emissions were documented by the TCEQ based on operations at over 588 tons per year, in addition to HAPs or hazardous air pollutions being put out by the facility in excess of permitted limits of 25 tons per year. Also, we know that a number of the emission sources were not even understood as far as how much VOCs they were producing. And while I was not continuous counsel through the citizen suit, I am aware of information that suggests the green hammer mills are putting out more in VOCs than even anticipated originally by the facility and maybe are even known by TCEQ. So we have a situation where the permitted limits and the amount of pollution this facility is putting out is disproportionate to those limits. And these controls are really important for these to be put in place. And the agency has known about this for a very long time. It has taken too long for this administrative order to be put in place. And while we're thankful that it is, we are still concerned that extensions will be extended to the facility again. And we are here today to enforce, stress that should not happen. the controls need to go in place. There are other types of facilities. This is the only one in Texas, but there are other types of facilities like this in the rest of the United States with these controls that do not have these same impacts on the neighborhood. This is a unique flower that was, you know, permitted in Texas without maybe a full understanding of what these facilities were capable of. And without the controls, they've really wreaked havoc on the community members that live nearby and lived there before the facility was opened.
So, Ms. Dinn, I do have, I think, maybe one more question for you, and that is that, you know, looking at Mr. Stafford's comments in particular, I do have questions about whether we arrived at an appropriate penalty. And there's always some tension on these agreed orders of whether it's better to move forward with them and start the clock on the relief that's called for under the orders to get it in and done and start doing that good, or if it's better to hold off. My inclination is, and I'll visit with my colleagues about it in a minute, is that in this case, it might make sense to continue the item so that we can gather more information. But I wanted your sense of whether it's better to enter the order today and get the relief today or take some more time with it. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, the primary thing that needs to happen is for those controls to be put in place, and that deadline is set for May 1st. As long as that is not impacted by any further consideration, that we would be okay with a review of the health impacts, which we agree have not been fully considered, and the amount of penalty being assessed by the agency. But in no way do we want any further delay of those controls being installed, because they should eliminate about 95% of the VOCs that are impacting the community at this time.
Thank you, Ms. Dinn. Ms. Cordell, Ms. Jablonski, if we were to continue this item, would that delay the controls?
Susan Jablonski with the Enforcement Division. So it is one of the provisions in the order, and so it would need to be effective to actuate that provision.
Okay. Appreciate that. Colleagues, questions or comments at this point?
Well, I was probably eventually going to ask the company that question, and I don't know if now would be an appropriate time or not, but, and I can be corrected, but my understanding is even if we were to say delay it, the company could still do that. There's nothing...
I think it's probably important for the community to have a legal obligation in place and not, I mean, I totally agree. The companies should be installing those controls,
right,
with all due speed, and they should beat their deadline, you know, whether they're under a legal obligation,
right,
to do that or not. But absent a legal obligation in the agreed order in front of us, there's no leverage. There's no enforcement.
Oh.
So.
Well, I guess we can ask we can do it now or wait if, but I was eventually going to ask the company probably that question or the representatives from the company.
We do still have one commenter signed in.
Why don't we listen to the next commenter, and then we'll hear from the respondent.
And that is Mr. Kenneth Lumen.
Good morning, Mr. Lumen. And sir, we can't hear you. It might be your mute button. You might check that. Mr. Lumen, are you there?
He may not be on the line.
Oh, okay. Tell you what, let's come back to Mr. Lumen, and we'll hear from the respondent now.
And I guess as they're walking up, my main two questions I was going to ask at some point for them were, you know, on the things that have been referenced today, I guess they referenced the filter. I don't know if that's the catalytic oxidizer or what exactly filter Ms. Lumen was referencing, but I am curious to know about where the company is on that, kind of what the delays have been so far, if they can discuss those, and then if they can also discuss what's the status of the federal operating permit, if that's something we can hear about, I'm curious about. So I'll stop.
Good morning. For the record, my name is Brian Shaw. I'm here representing Woodville Pellets. Also have with us Marcella Burke, who's an attorney representing the company, and Patrick Runge, working with the company as well. If I can, I'd like to address some of the issues and that you've sort of had questions about. Everything is, to my understanding, is on track for the installment of the RCO, which is the control device to remove those VOC emissions. And so that deadline, as far as I'm aware, is still being met. I think the company will continue to move post haste to get that done. However, I think part of the issue with regard to whether it's appropriate to delay this has to do with, you know, trying to move to where they're on the compliance side of things. And if you look at the justification that was utilized to convince the executive director staff that this would be a moderate instead of a major harm, was looking at the TCEQ's own modeling that was done in the previous permitting action. And that is, the permit was about to be issued by TCEQ, not requiring any controls at all. And that was looking at those same VOC emissions that are the subject of this enforcement item. The TCEQ actually had a proposed permit, and it went out, and only because it had to be reissued for public notice concerns did they reconsider that. And so using TCEQ's own modeling, the reason for the requirement for controls had to do with VOCs and ozone in the area. It was not because it exceeded any National Ambient Air Quality Standard or expect screening level at the property line or in the community. And so TCEQ's own data demonstrated that since TCEQ was available and was willing to issue the permit at the time with no controls, that certainly having those emissions out there didn't cause a harm. There's also a subject of the confusion was, it's perceived by the company, and I think is accurate, that there was an understanding between the TCEQ and the previous permittee that the company had time to continue operating while they built the RTO, the thermal oxidizer. However, that was not put explicitly in the permit. And so the new owner didn't realize that until they had made the purchase out of bankruptcy, and then there were complaints, and TCEQ looked at it and saw in that permit that was issued, there was a time frame given to put the RTO, to install the RTO, but there was no provision saying you can continue to operate in the meantime. You're familiar, TCEQ doesn't typically make that kind of authorization and shut down a facility unless they're explicitly saying we're going to shut you down. And so I think there was a failure on the part of the previous permittee to make sure that that component was included in the permit. But I think that data that TCEQ's and that analysis shows that TCEQ's own modeling indicated that there would be no harm associated with that. And so clearly, if there would be no harm associated with uncontrolled emissions, then the uncontrolled emissions that have happened in the interim should not also cause major harm. So that was the justification and the reason perhaps that it didn't show up more prevalently in the documentation is because it was based on TCEQ's own modeling at the time.
Thank you for that, Mr. Shaw. I have a couple quick reactions to that. One is I understand that explanation. My problem is that we didn't have the benefit of that explanation until right now, and certainly the commenters didn't have that either, and I'm also familiar with environmental due diligence work in transactional lawyering, and so I'm sorry that the ball was dropped on that environmental due diligence. Anyway, those are just
Can I address to some extent? I agree with you, and the company has recognized that they dropped the ball. That's why they've entered into this agreement. And I might also add that under typical TCEQ protocol, the emissions that would be considered for this agreed order would have stopped at the date that the enforcement matter was, and I forget the terminology you use at TCEQ, but basically it went through and normally that would stop. The company asked for TCEQ to consider an additional 6 months of emissions to make sure that all of the emissions were covered because they wanted to make sure that they were able to dispose of this item and move on in being in compliance. And so they offered and asked for additional consideration. By the way, those additional emissions were then brought in on the latest penalty policy, and so those were, as it turns out, about twice the penalty rate that you would have had based on the previous 6 months that this initial AO was based on. And so the company recognizes that even though there was a misunderstanding, that it was their responsibility to make sure that they had that authorization, and so that's why they've worked to this agreed order to come before you today.
Appreciate that explanation. Commissioner Lindley, other questions?
The only other question I was going to ask is about the federal operating permit. So the status of that.
Yeah. So what happened with the federal operating permit is the They actually applied for the renewal of the federal operating permit before it expired, but you're probably aware if you don't do that at least 6 months prior to the expiration, there's no guarantee that it will move forward. And I think they were 4 months prior, and so they end up having comments, adverse comments that arrive, and so they had to go through that contested process. That's well underway. I believe that, and certainly this agreed order would provide that they continue operating under the old agreed order until they finalize the new Title V permit. And so it's been in works. They've been working with staff, the air permitting staff, to make sure that all of that is moving forward, and everything seems to be on track for that to be approved fairly quickly, I believe.
Any other questions?
I appreciate it. I think you answered all the questions that I had intended to ask the respondent today in your explanation. So thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Smith, is there anyone else signed in to speak on item 7?
No. Did you want to give Mr. Lumen one more opportunity?
Oh, thank you. Yeah, Mr. Yeah. Lumen, I'm sorry. We were unable to connect with you before. Are you with us now?
So I understand that his name isn't appearing on the webinar, and we've looked for him on the webinar and can't find him. So if he's not responding, I think we could move on.
Just may not be with us. Okay. I might give him one more shot.
Have one final question for ED staff.
Yeah, please.
Partly in response to the points raised by the respondent on the issue earlier. Speaking to the basis of the demonstration, the basis to reevaluate from major to moderate, some of the violations under violation 1 and 2 under this agreed order. I just wanted to ask if you could speak to add anything to Dr. Shaw's explanation of the look back. My question that I intended to ask on that point was, what was that basis? Was it modeling that was new modeling that was provided or something else? And it sounds like it's pointing back to a previous evaluation by our agency. I wanted to just ask you to comment further on that.
Yes, this is Melissa Cordell with Enforcement Division. So the respondent did provide documentation demonstrating that during the review of the new source review permit number 98014 amendment application, and that was submitted on October 1st, 2018. And the applicant provided error dispersion modeling for a worst case scenario of 515.24. This is what glasses are for. Tons per year of uncontrolled VOC emissions from the dry hammer mills and cooler air aspiration system, demonstrating that the uncontrolled VOC emissions were below the effect screening levels and air monitoring comparison values for each speciated VOC. So speaking to that, it was in relation to the previous application.
I appreciate that, and I think that helps clarify for me when it's modeling specifically addressing a worst case scenario. I think that's a very adequate and sufficient demonstration for our agents to be able to point to, and it's hard to argue back against that where we're talking about these particular VOC limits and concentrations. So I appreciate the explanation. Thank you.
Ms. Cordell, did I miss that? Was that in our backup material and I just failed to find it on this agreed order?
I believe that was part of my preparation for today and not necessarily in the backups. So
not in the backup
apologies.
Material. Okay. All right. Colleagues, other comments or questions at this point? We still have our public interest counsel that we need to hear from. Let's hear from Mr. McWhirter. Good morning.
Good morning. Things sort of shifted during your discussion, and it sounds like now we may be headed toward a continuance to consider.
It's an open question, I think. Yeah.
Well, I'll just point out, not to toot my own horn, but I had the same questions you did about what the demonstration was, and I've had a few email exchanges with staff. Personally, I wasn't convinced that the modeling that was submitted by the applicant before they got the 2019 permit should be used by them to reduce the penalty from major harm to minor harm. And I think that was because, you know, that was before they got the permit. It was before the real life experiences that have occurred with people when they've been there. And one of the things that kept getting my attention as I looked through this was When that permit amendment was received on April 5th, 2019, the permit was amended to include special provisions to cut VOC emissions by 95%. The control device then that was required, you've heard mention of the RTO, that's the regenerative thermal oxidizer, was required to reduce emissions from the dry hammer mill and the cooler air aspiration system. And special provision 10 in that permit that was issued stated, the RTO shall be started up before sources associated with the dry hammer mill and cooler air aspiration system begin production and shall only be shut down after equipment has ceased operations. But for 2 years, those operations continued. The RTO was not built. It sounds like there was a lot of background maybe that we don't know about, you know, discussions with staff or the region as to why that happened. But it just is hard to reconcile on paper as to why that disregard of that special provision doesn't come into play more in considering the penalty. So as I came in here today, my recommendation to you was OPIC can't support the order because we don't think the penalty is high enough. So, and that's still where we stand today.
Okay, thank you, Mr. McWhirter. Colleagues, I propose that we maybe discuss this item and close it out before we move on to the other enforcement items so it's fresh. I am on the fence. I have questions about, this is a big penalty, but the violations are also very serious. I have questions about whether it is the right penalty for the violations and would, as I suggested earlier, would like to get some more information around that, show our work a little bit more. On the other hand, we have an opportunity to create a legal obligation, even though they're moving towards installing the equipment, creating a legal obligation right now to install it by May 1. So I could probably be persuaded either way, Commissioner Lindley or Commissioner Janeka, if you want to share your thoughts.
You know, I came in today ready to move forward adopting the agreed order. You know, and you mentioned earlier that you were thinking about continuing. I think I'm still on the page of adopting the agreed order because I think I fall just a little bit more on I want to legalize this and I just want things done legally. I want things that the company has to do to have a firm backing. And I don't know of another way to do that other than adopting the agreed order. But, you know, I think I'd be willing to continue it, but I don't want to continue it long, right? I mean, I'd probably want to do it just till the next agenda. And I know that probably puts, if we were to do it, let me say that. Just because I don't want to get far into April at all if we don't take it up today. So, I didn't make that real clear, but
that's, I thought it was clear. Yeah,
kind of where I am.
A little, maybe a little bit on the fence. Willing to.
Am willing. Yeah, I'm more. I won't put percentages on it. But yeah.
Commissioner Janeka.
Well, I found Mr. McWhirter's arguments convincing, and I'm more of a mind with you now to remand. But that raises specifically the question that was in my mind that Commissioner Lindley named.
Let me interject.
Okay, yes.
First of all, continue. Not remand.
Right.
I'm also a little bit less in the camp of continue now after hearing Ms. Din
there is
say
no
that the most important thing for
requirement.
Her is to have a deadline on the pollution control equipment. So still on the fence, not arguing for a continuance, just to be clear.
I think that I will be comfortable going either way. I find some new questions in my mind regarding that modeling basis of previous demonstration, and clearly where there are controls necessary, where there are clear impacts on the community, and we're looking for the construction of this regenerative thermal oxidizer as a necessary piece of their fully compliant operations. I'm curious in my mind where we departed from that modeling basis that existed and we received and reviewed in conjunction with this permit amendment in 2019 versus where we got today. And so I'd certainly love to hear more from Edie at some point, and I don't know that it is relevant to dig into on this one. And I had well, not to muddy the waters too much more, but on we've had several mentions of the Green Hammer Mill, and I think that involves open allegations and other ongoing issues that may yet come before us and that aren't here in the order today. And I just wanted to comment on one aspect of that. And I noticed in the ED's response to comments regarding Sierra Club's comments about that Green Hammer Mill, which again is not a violation at issue in this proposed agreed order, I noticed that the ED had been carefully policing the Audit Privilege Act. And I understand that the alleged Green Hammer Mill violations have been referred to the Beaumont region for investigation. And in light of this information, I'm confident that Woodville's audit will be carefully reviewed to ensure that there's no abuse of the act. And that's all I have to say here, since there are potentially still pending matters. But in light of the fact that there are many moving parts and pieces, we're dealing with federal operating permits. I've heard mentioned of separate citizen or civil suits regarding nuisance violations and issues, particularly noise, which I don't understand our agency has any oversight over. So I remain troubled that there are messages getting out to community members of the community that they should be withdrawing from those sorts of suits, because I don't know how we give them relief on things like noise. But I'm all those factors, I think I'm comfortable with moving forward with approval of the order today in the interest of getting us most swiftly to having a actionable deadline in regards to the federal operating permit and other remediation provisions here.
Can we pause for 2 minutes? I've got a question from Mary.
Yes.
Wanted to ask real quick.
And after that, I'm going to propose that we hear from the respondent, that we give Mr. Lumen another chance if he can join us, and then we try to close this out. Yeah. Come right back. All right, we are back, not after a recess, but just a short sidebar, and I think we're going to hear from a couple more commenters on this item. First, from the respondent. Good morning again.
Good morning. Marcella Bird. I represent
Will you check your mic, make sure that's there we go. Yes. Now we got you.
Good morning. Thank you so much. I represent Woodville Pellets. My name is Marcella Burke. And I just wanted to address a couple things that have been coming up about the VOCs and the harm. That there's different types of VOCs, and these types of VOCs associated with wood, which is what is involved here, are ozone precursors. That's why they're regulated. They're not regulated as a risk to health. And so there's actually been no proof of risk to health. There's been no stipulation. There's been any harm to health. And every single comment that was made by people who've called in have made allegations of harm to health that the company has never, ever acquiesced to or been willing to admit to at all. Instead, though, they bought the company out of bankruptcy. They're very happy to make updates to equipment When the Title V permit was going to be an automatic extension, but it was bought out of bankruptcy. It was the beginning of COVID. It was a month late for the automatic re-extension. It was an administrative oversight that we believe has been duly exploited over the last 3 years. And there are millions and millions of dollars now that are being made. Sierra Club is very of investments in the plant under the new ownership. Sierra Club's very happy with the agreed order. I'll note EIP was part of the lawsuit, and they're here today, but they're not here to comment on this particular case. And they told us they were not planning on commenting. And also, all these things had come up during audit. So the company was under audit when a lot of this was discovered, that under the purchase, under the new owners, let's go under audit and look at what we can see. And this was found under audit. And so I'll also mention that as well. And so I think all those are factors here. The company has gone above and beyond, is very involved in the community, is doing a lot to not only update the plant, but also the community as well. And the people here who are making allegations are personnel injury allegations, and those are best resolved. They're not resolved, I should say, statutorily or regulatory by this agency. And so I want to say on the record here that we admit no harm, that we think that any comment that there's any kind of harm is unfounded, but we are very happy to answer any questions. And we would like to request that the AO be voted on today, but if not, and you have any questions, we're very happy to provide any supplemental information. But we would also say yes, we would really appreciate to have this resolved as soon as possible, either way, but happy to answer any further technical questions as well.
Thank you, Ms. Burke, and I think your colleague wants to chime in here too.
So one point of clarification, somewhat mentioned by Mr. McWhorter, and with regard to the provision, the ordering provision that talked about that the RTO need to be started up before the dry hammer mills operated and not shut down until after. It's my understanding that was an operational procedure that once it's built, that's the way you would operate. You would basically fire that up on startup and shutdown, that you would fire it up first. And so it wasn't made clear at all that was supposed to happen before operations continued. And in fact, the TCQ gave an original 18-month time period for construction of the RTO. And so it was an oversight by the company, but it appears it was very much understood that they were going to continue to operate while the RTO was built. Once built, that would be the operating procedure, whereby you wouldn't fire up the mill and then turn on the RTO. You would heat up the RTO to make sure it's at operating temperatures so that the emissions, when they reach the RTO, are immediately processed and destructed. So that was just a clarification on why I believe that ordering provision makes sense in the context of it should have said once the RTO is constructed. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shaw.
I'm happy to answer.
Seeing none, one more try for Mr. Lumen. Are you there, sir? All right, hearing nothing. Good grief, we are wishy-washy. Can I just say that? Mr. McWhorter, did you have something to add?
I had one question, maybe. I don't know if there's someone here who may be able to answer this, but I know there was another permit amendment dated, I believe, April 8th, 2021, that calls for a switch from the type of control device from the RTO to what's called the RCO, the regenerative catalytic oxidizer. And I was just curious if that permit amendment established any sort of timeline for construction that would be enforceable separate and apart from the enforcement order.
Thank you for the question. Let's give Mr. Shaw an opportunity to answer that.
Yeah, that is the control device that is subject of this agreed order. The RCO is replacing the RTO because the owner is very environmentally conscious, and they wanted to find a technology that created fewer NOx. And so the RTO has greater NOx emissions. And so they researched and determined that an RCO would be more favorable from that standpoint. That's part of the reason that there was, the company was really adamant about trying to make sure that they were able to provide a more environmentally friendly, from their viewpoint, control device for that. And so that's part of this agreed order.
Thank you, Mr. Shaw. Colleagues, let me propose this. We have very serious violations. We have a very serious penalty. Questions about whether the penalties match the violation. We heard from Ms. Dinn that the most important thing is to make sure that there's a deadline on these controls. There's not, unless we enter into the agreed order. The respondent, of course, wants us to enter an agreed order. I think I'll get off the fence and propose that we move ahead and enter this agreed order. Commissioner Lindley.
I'm in agreement. I think that's the most important thing to do at this point.
Commissioner Janeka.
Likewise.
All right. We have another item we get to talk about. Number 11. Ms. Smith, please call the first interested person on item 11, please.
Ms. Amy Din, again.
Hello again, Ms. Din.
Good morning again, commissioners. We appreciate your time. This is Amy Din again with Lone Star Legal Aid, this time on behalf of Port Arthur Community Action Network in Port Arthur regarding the administrative order proposed for Motiva Enterprises. We submitted comments on this agreed order in October 2020 related to overflow after Hurricane Harvey in a city ditch right away, which was observed and reported to TCEQ at the time. That report included pictures that were part of our 2020 comments on the proposed penalty. The letter we received in February 2022 in response to comments suggested this event was different from what was being penalized and the administrative order and would be reported to the Beaumont office. These statements were concerning because it had been reported to the Beaumont office in 2017 and it's now 2022. We were told, you know, there's now nothing there to investigate. So we had also tracked this investigation to enforcement after talking to multiple people at TCEQ, which was what we thought had led to this agreed order, which not unlike the Savannah Deli thing that we visited a few months ago, we were told this is not the same thing. We have now been assured by TCEQ that the Beaumont office did investigate and fully remediate the issue that was observed and reported in 2017. And that's probably the most important thing at the end of the day. We plan to ensure the documentation of that investigation is shared with community members who observed this issue on their street during Harvey. And I personally saw the pollution here at issue. But what remains a concern to Pecan is that this is the second time we've followed an investigation based on reports that were made, particularly during Harvey, only to be told later after a penalty is up for public comment that this is something different. The process needs to be more transparent to connect an investigation efforts reported by a community to TCEQ enforcement. There should be clear communication based on the public reports that come into TCEQ. Hey, I see this on my street. Hey, I'm smelling something. A tracking number, something that gets assigned to that report that then when it goes to enforcement, there is a clear connection for the community member that this enforcement action relates back to that report I made 4 years ago. And that we can clearly tie those. So we have transparency between what is being reported by the community that's trying to help TCEQ, as Commissioner Janetica acknowledged earlier, which we appreciate, to what's being happening at the enforcement agency. So that's our suggestion today for consideration by the agency to improve enforcement, to improve transparency, and to help the community connect these dots. We have confidence in what the agency is doing and that the remediation is getting done in response to these community reports. So thank you for your time today and listening to this concern.
Thank you, Ms. Din. I think that's a very good comment. We also got your written comment, so we appreciate that. Let me ask ED staff, do we do that already? Is there a way to track a particular complaint or investigation through to the enforcement matter? How do our fellow Texans easily connect the dots?
Susan Jablonski for the Enforcement Division. Yes, so there is tracking. There's both a number given when a complaint comes in for tracking, and that is on a public facing website, so they can track the outcome associated with that. And then there's an investigation number that gets tracked with what gets covered. In this case, there was some overlap with the investigation, which caused some of the confusion because of Harvey instances of the general complaints from the community of observed issues and then specific things that were being followed up at Motiva. And so I think that overlap caused some of the confusion. We spent some time visiting with Ms. Den to talk through that and verified with the region that that complaint at Hurricane Harvey was resolved with remedial action. And so I think we've seen a couple of these, particularly with hurricane response, that tends to have some overlap with observations that are being made in the field for an investigation that would be more routine that has this overlay of a disaster occurring as well. And so we will continue to try to make improvements in our transparency and tying those things and making sure when we have commenters that we're keeping those communication lines open. And in this case, I'm glad that Ms. Den brought the issue and we were able to get the information before this issue came in front of y'all.
Thank you, Mr. Jablonski. And all of this is just kind of a process note that's outside the scope of the item that's before us right now. And let me just suggest maybe that Ms. Den, you and Mr. Jablonski visit with each other and hopefully close that gap, you know, show you how we do it, and maybe that will be sufficient. If it's not, you can bring it back, maybe not at the commission, but I would certainly welcome a meeting in my office just for my own benefit to make sure that we're helping the public, Ms. Den, as you say, connect the dots between their input to the agency and then the agency's ultimate action. All right, where are we? Next commenter, I believe. Ms. Smith, please call the next person.
And that's Mr. John Beard, Jr.
Good morning, Mr. Beard.
Good morning, Chairman Jenica. Good morning, TCEQ commissioners, the counselors. Once again, good morning to each of you. I would like to speak to, and in some ways co-sign what Ms. Den has said. I am the founder and CEO of the Port Arthur Community Action Network on Environmental, Social Justice and Community Development Organization. And with regard to this complaint we filed, I'm in total agreement with Ms. Den that there seems to be something amiss. There's some disconnect in the way these things have been handled. It almost seems like, in some ways, a bait and switch. And I would not use such a term if it were not for the fact that, as Ms. Den mentioned, with the Savannah Deli incident that we had and we reported, a community report, and we were engaged in very recently, that there seems to be a difference of how information is transferred and utilized, and it's like the left hand doesn't know what the right hand's doing. And that should not be happening in your agency or even with our communities in terms of their service to us and in terms of addressing these environmental issues. Transparency, accuracy, and timeliness are crucial in this to our communities because you are one of the primary and the first line sources of relief we have. We don't have anything on the county level, don't have anything on the city. So you guys are it, and we need for that system to work. Another issue I'd like to speak to you about with the remaining time is regarding this SEP. And my concern with this SEP is twofold. One, that the list of SEPs having served on City Council in Port Arthur during the time this was put together, this was over 10 years ago. I was last on council in 2012, and this was done before 2012. And it does not accurately reflect the science nor the needs of the community today. The SEP was given to an organization that handles whether it's a high emissions vehicle project in terms of using alternative fuels. But we found that whether you burn hydrocarbon fuels in a cleaner form, you're still contributing to air pollution. Pollution is still pollution. It's just less pollution. But with all the increase in those sources in Southeast Texas, with the expansion of a number of these petrochemical facilities, new LNG facilities coming online, pipelines, and then the tens of thousands of additional cars coming into our city, the situation is only getting exacerbated. It's not being made better. So that needs to be updated, and that's something that TCEQ needs to give to the city of Port Arthur because it's been over 10 years. So once again, I thank you for your work, and I applaud your work. But at the same time, there are serious gaps and concerns here that need to be addressed in a number of areas, as Ms. Den and I have both said. Once again, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Beard. As for your process note about transparency, accuracy, and timeliness, I totally agree. I might suggest that you join Ms. Den on the call with Mr. Jablonski to try to sort through those issues. As for the SEPs, I wasn't really, because it wasn't in the background material, there are no comments about the SEPs. I'm not really in a position to respond to that, I hear your concerns. I would note that we have a work session coming up on SEPs. I stole Commissioner Janeka's thunder on that. I would invite you particularly to join us for that. Colleagues, any other comments or questions for Mr. Beard?
I wanted to thank him specifically for that comment about the SEP. I found it instructive in light of our discussion we're expecting tomorrow morning. I was wondering if it was a meeting that was on his radar, whether he was aware of it, and I just want
is that tomorrow about, already?
It is.
Oh my gosh.
I did the proximity of it. I was going to ask the question as a simple testing our agencies how well things are working in terms of notifying the public about information they may care about. So, Ms. Brett, I just wonder, were you aware that we have a work session tomorrow on the topic of SEPs generally? And I'm very cautious about not straying off of our posted agenda. So I just want to ask that in particular to the timing of when we're hearing from the public on items such as these.
Unfortunately, no, I wasn't aware of it. But if there's where I can give written comment, matter of fact, I'm talking to you now from another conference that I'm at. So I'm kind of doubled up and balled up on things. But that's something that's critical to me, that what you're saying. And if I can, I'll try to listen in or be a part of that. If you have someone send me the information on it, if not, I'll send in written comments. But I think it's crucial and it's good that you all are looking into it. So thank you.
Sincerely appreciate that. Answered my question. And a good reminder, we're all very, very busy these days. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Beard. Ms. Smith, do we have anybody else signed in on number 11?
No one signed in who wishes to address the company or address the matter. However, I'll note that the respondent is present.
All right, thank you for that. Mr. McWhorter, what are your thoughts on item 11?
I don't have any objection to the order, and I appreciate the ED's efforts to work with the community to address those concerns they raise.
Thank you. Colleagues, I'm not sure we really have any outstanding issues on 11, but let me put that question to you. I'll ask you first, Commissioner Janeka, thoughts on item 11.
I appreciate it. I had one question that I'd noted and planned to ask, and I've heard quite a bit to clarify that and answer some of my confusion on there. I will just, I'm good. Yeah, thank you.
Commissioner Lindley.
I'm good. I don't have any questions, and I would be comfortable adopting what's proposed before us today.
All right, thank you, Ms. Smith. Is anyone else signed in to speak on the enforcement docket?
No.
And Mr. McWhorter, do you have thoughts on any of the other items on the enforcement docket?
I support the other items other than item 7.
Okay, thank you. I think we've heard from everybody we need to on the enforcement docket. I think the commission has discussed its position on everything, so I think we're ready for a motion.
I will make the motion that we adopt items 2 through 18 as recommended today by the executive director.
I second.
The motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. The motion carries. Ms. Smith, please call the next item.
The next item is the consideration of the monthly enforcement report, and the executive director's staff is here to present the item.
Good morning again.
Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners, General Counsel, and Public Interest Counsel. My name is Melissa Cordell of the Enforcement Division, and with me are Susan Jablonski, also of Enforcement Division, and Gitanjali Yadav of the Litigation Division. We are here to present the monthly enforcement report for fiscal year 2022 through January. There were 470 effective administrative orders issued, and of those, 67 contained supplemental environmental projects. These orders assessed a total of $5,919,858 in penalties, with a payable amount of $3,670,204. $1,346,203 are to be paid towards supplemental environmental projects. 5,699 notices of violation have been issued through either our field offices or review of self-reported data in our central office, and 844 enforcement action referrals have been received. There are 1,787 pending administrative orders, with 383 cases that are on the backlog. 191 cases are pending at the Attorney General's Office for representation in district court, and 8 judgments have been issued. 2,149 cases are being tracked for compliance. We have included for review a summary of OCE investigative activities for fiscal years 2020, 21, and 22. We are available to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Ms. Cordell. I have none. Commissioner Lindley, any questions?
No questions, thanks.
Commissioner Janeka.
I appreciate it. No questions.
Ms. Smith, has anyone signed in to speak on this item?
No.
And Mr. McWhirter, what are your thoughts?
I don't have any questions. Thanks for the report.
Appreciate the report. Colleagues, no action is necessary on this item. So, Ms. Smith, we have been going for an hour and a half. I think the next item is we have a good number of folks signed in to speak, so it's going to take a good chunk of time. I wanted to get your temperature on whether we should take a break, a recess. I have a yes.
I would love a quick break.
Yes.
Yes.
How long?
I have 5 minutes at the most. 3 minutes.
There may well be an unmet need for bathroom breaks as well in the audience. So
why don't we take a? Why don't we? And I appreciate everybody's patience. Why don't we take a 10-minute break and we'll return at 11 o'clock straight up.
Sounds good.
With that, we stand in recess. It's 11 o'clock. We're back after a short recess. Ms. Smith, I'll ask you to please call the next item.
The next item is the consideration of the petition for rulemaking for the addition of 30 Texas Administrative Code Chapter 311, subchapter K, to prohibit the permitting of discharges of treated domestic wastewater effluent to certain streams. Petitioners are the moving party and should present the matter, followed by the ED, OPIC, and then interested persons. Due to the high number of petitioners and the anticipated public interest, OGC recommends providing 10 minutes each to petitioners collectively, which may be divided among the multiple petitioners, the ED, and OPIC. OGC also recommends 2 minutes each to interested persons with a total presentation limit for those interested persons of 1 hour. For all speakers, I would like to remind you to limit your comments to the petition. You should not discuss permits that the agency is still considering or ongoing enforcement actions. These matters have the potential to come before the commission for a decision and are not noticed for this meeting so that the other parties would have an opportunity to respond and could jeopardize future enforcement. And with that, I think we're ready for the petitioners, and I understand that I can't read my own handwriting, but I understand we have two representatives from those petitioners.
All right, so the petitioners, I'll invite you up now, and you'll have, the petitioners will have 10 minutes to share. Good morning. And check your microphone. There's a little button that says, probably says push if it's like mine.
Okay.
There we now, go. We got you.
Good morning, and thank you for having me. I'm Jeannie Dolnig, and I spoke to TCEQ officials about 20 years ago when I represented the stewards of the Nueces, and our group fought with great support from the state for a legislation banning motorized vehicles in Texas rivers and streams. It became law in 2003. I've also served on Texas Parks and Wildlife's Texas Conservation Rivers Advisory Board. My husband has served on the Nueces River Authority for 12 years, and for 2 years he was president. Our family ranch has been in our family for 4 generations, and it's on the Nueces River, and we have loved and respected that river for 70 years. Our children, grandchildren, our family have enjoyed the clear waters, and we have witnessed the public enjoying those same waters for fishing and kayaking and swimming. You can see a picture. These are the rivers we're talking about. Today, time flies, I am here representing the Pristine Streams team, as well as thousands of Texans asking the TCEQ to support our rule change petition prohibiting new wastewater discharges into these last few remaining streams in Texas. Pristine streams and rivers are revered for their beauty. Water so clear you can see the bottom when you walk, swim, fish, or paddle in the rivers. Many people across the state take family vacations in the rural areas where these rivers are located. Garner Park is the most popular park in the state, and mainly because of the beautiful, clear waters of the Frio. These pristine streams are crystal clear because they contain undetectable phosphorus. Using TCEQ's own data on samples taken over the past 10 years shows, sadly, that only 22 classified stream segments are considered to be pristine. These classified stream segments account for less than 1% of all rivers and streams in Texas. This is shocking to me that over 1,800 classified rivers and streams were down to 22 segments, and these are now in jeopardy. Excuse me. It's also inconceivable to me that we have to be here fighting to protect them. Texas is booming and thriving, and that's good. However, growth and development brings population, and population means the need for wastewater disposal. This makes our rule change petition even more urgent, as the desire for the inexpensive method of wastewater discharge into streams will increase. Various entities apply for discharge permits from TCEQ, and if approved, they proceed. Even the most advanced methods of wastewater treatment cannot treat water to match the quality of water found in these pristine streams. As a result, this wastewater discharge forces the downstream neighbors to contend with degraded water quality, algae blooms, and the destruction of the most significant attribute of a pristine stream that Texans enjoy, water clarity. There is an alternative to direct discharge of wastewater. The TCEQ, as you know, has a Texas Land Application Permit, or TLAP, for such use. Forward-thinking cities such as the city of Lakey, Campwood, many state parks and natural areas dispose of their treated wastewater by TLAP. We are asking that this be the only means permitted for disposing wastewater effluent within the watersheds of this small number of pristine streams. Only a complete prohibition of new wastewater discharge permits will preserve the water quality and clarity of these streams. And again, we're only talking about 1%. TCEQ has the responsibility and the authority to preserve and protect Texas natural resources. However, when a direct discharge permit has been applied for, it has been conservationist groups, landowners, and river enthusiasts that have had to fight against these at their own expense. We are here today asking you to do the right thing for Texas and for future generations of Texans who have a right to recreate in clean, clear rivers and streams in their natural state. We ask that you approve a prohibition of new wastewater discharge permits into the few remaining classified pristine streams in Texas. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you, Ms. Dalnick.
David Langford will speak.
Good morning, Mr. Langford.
Good morning. Thank you for providing time to speak on behalf of the remaining pristine streams in our state. I am David K. Langford. I live on our family's seven-generation ranch near Comfort, and our main creeks flow into the Guadalupe River, a couple of miles downstream from Comfort. I have been in the leadership of the Texas Wildlife Association since 1985 and served two terms on the Regional Water Planning Group. Executive Director Baker has recommended that a rule change should not be supported. We disagree, and here's why. The legislature has clearly recognized that TCEQ is the most appropriate branch of our state government for making this decision. This fact is supported by the letter from former chairman of the House Natural Resources Committee. In his letter to Margot Dinky, dated June 12, 2019, via a March 18, 2022 e-filing by Dr. Dinky, Chairman Larson writes, "We are mindful of concerns about how the introduction of certain nutrients found in treated wastewater into the Nueces River could otherwise impact the river, and wanted to share with you information on the process of petitioning TCEQ to evaluate these impacts and do rulemaking on this issue as was done in the two areas discussed above." Those two areas discussed above in his letter are the Highland Lakes and the Edwards Aquifer, areas where no direct discharge of wastewater is allowed, and for good reason. So not only do we have a roadmap suggested by a former House committee chairman, TCEQ has a history of enacting alternative solutions to prevent discharge without taking a stand on the issue. The failure to take a stand, to make a rule that is clear to all, has led to unnecessary and expensive divisiveness between developers and adjacent and downstream landowners. It is time to make a formal rule change. In this sunset review year, A rule change would be a positive step TCEQ can take to recognize the public outcry that these few remaining pristine streams demand protection from pollution. It's TCEQ's job to do this, and now's a good time to get it done. I would like to close by making three additional comments. TCEQ has been accommodating and creative in solving issues such as this in the past. Second, there is a huge volume of support for keeping our pristine rivers pristine. You have received over 1,200 individual responses in support, some of which are from associations representing many more thousands of citizen supporters. There are alternatives. For example, all the homes on our extended family's ranch have septic systems, as do our neighbors. So alternatives are readily available and should be the only method allowed in these sensitive waterways. My final comment is this. This is a property rights issue. Dating back to 1985, you will find my property rights resume is impeccable. However, many conveniently forget that property rights go both ways. My neighbor's property rights end at my family's fence line. Somehow the scales which measure property rights have become out of balance. And this issue is a perfect example. The scales are heavily weighted in favor of the dumpers and are dismissed and diminished for those who are dumped on. Please overrule the existing recommendation and allow a measured, appropriate rulemaking process to solve this issue in a fair and just manner for all Texans. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Langford. I think we're going to hear next from the executive director's staff.
Good morning, Commissioners, General Counsel, Public Interest Counsel. On behalf of the Executive Director, I'm Earl Lott, Director of the Office of Water. With me today are Greg Easley and Shannon Gibson of the Water Quality Division, as well as Anthony Tatu from the Environmental Law today. Before you today is a petition to amend 30 Texas Administrative Code Chapter 311 Watershed Protection Rules. The petitioners, as requested, are seeking to prohibit the discharge of treated domestic wastewater into certain segments with historically low detectable phosphorus levels as determined over the past 10 years. Based on the memo submitted March 11, 2022, the executive director respectfully requests denial of the petition based on the fact that the prior six legislative sessions, bills have been filed aimed at prohibiting discharges as well as seeking studies to study these stream segments, and none of these bills have been passed into law. Additionally, we feel like prohibiting discharges has a potential to impact at least 60 existing permittees that have discharge permits along these segments, as well as prohibit growth by increasing disposal costs for wastewater discharges. Thank you, and we're available to address any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Lott. Colleagues, any questions or comments at this point? Commissioner Lindley, no? Commissioner Janeka? All right. Let's hear next from the Office of Public Interest Counsel, Mr. McWhirter.
Good morning. OPIC recommends initiating rulemaking for further review of the issues raised by the petition and further meetings with stakeholders. I understand the concerns the executive director has raised, but I still think it's worth exploring these issues. And in some respects, it seems like this particular proposal may be more narrow in scope than some of the proposals that have been considered by the legislature in the past, and identifying a specific list of streams that would be protected. And there may be other differences too, but that's OPIC's recommendation.
Thank you, Mr. McWhirter. And we'll hear next from interested persons. Ms. Smith, will you please call the first person?
Ms. Carolyn Ahrens.
Good morning.
Good morning. This is what you get when your last name starts with an A.
That's right.
My name is Carolyn Ahrens. I live at 149 Waterford Lane in Georgetown, Texas. My husband and I bought the property in 2014 with our three children. 2004, it extends into the South San Gabriel, the South Fork of the San Gabriel, where upstream, 4 miles upstream, there is the Liberty Hill Wastewater Treatment Plant. My 13-year-old likes to fish in the river. Unfortunately, over the last 7-8 years, it is almost not fishable. We took a picture of a dead carp the other day. He said, "Mom, can you please go and talk to them? Can we please get this back to where it used to be?" Used to be that we had birthday parties down on the river and the kids were in the water. And that only happens now after a big gully trencher, whatever. Otherwise, it's just algae and dead. So I understand there's a petition for Liberty Hill to put an additional wastewater treatment plant on the same river that's already dead. Please, please, from my 13-year-old named Will, please protect our low-flowing, almost no-flowing in the summer rivers that with this phosphorus limit. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Ahrens. Ms. Smith, please call the next person.
Mr. Paul DeFiore. Sorry if I...
Mr. DeFiore? I may be mispronouncing. DeFiore, Mr. Paul DeFiore. And if you're joining us virtually, you might check your mute button. All right, let's loop back. Next person.
Mr. Peter Cross.
Mr. Cross. Let's loop back.
Mr. Daniel Wheelis.
Mr. Wheelis. Morning, sir.
Morning. Morning, commissioners. Thanks for attending to this matter. It needs your attention. This is really about the net worth of the entire state of Texas, and I think you can rest assured that this represents a cross-section of the whole state, the people here, from ranchers, townspeople, to environmental groups. I think you can be rest assured that this is a cross-section. The whole state of Texas needs these waters protected. They are the last ones. They provide incredible value to the entire state of Texas. If we lose them, we diminish the net worth of this entire state. So I'm not sure that the Commission on Environmental Quality always looks at net worth issues, but this is one, and it is staring us in the face, and since we have a viable, workable, cost-effective alternative to stream discharges with the land application program. It works so well around the Highland Lakes. There's development like crazy, you know, everybody's making money, and you know, it seems that the solution is literally off the shelf. Let's use it. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Smith, call the next person.
Dita Devine.
Ms. Devine. Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Dita Devine, and I am a city council member in the city of Blanco. While I'm here today representing myself, I have brought copies with me of the resolution that the city of Blanco passed unanimously last month supporting the Pristine Streams rule change. The city of Blanco is in a rather unique position in that we currently hold a discharge permit. But as a city, we've seen firsthand the impact of algae bloom. given our previous discharge policy. So for the last 18 months, I have served on a task force created by the city, charged to find solutions that meet the needs of our city's current infrastructure limitations, but that also protect the river that's the lifeblood of our community by completely avoiding discharge. I'm happy to report we have found those solutions and are moving toward amending our permit to phase out all discharge and into a TLAP. Protecting the quality of water in these last remaining pristine streams is not only the right thing to do as conservation stewards of the river, but from an economic point of view, it is also critical. The majority of our city's revenue comes from tourism that's directly tied to the Blanco River that runs not only through our city, but through the state park that brings thousands of visitors to our area every year. Without the clear, clean waters of the Blanco, the tourism that allows our community to economically thrive would be lost. We're staring down the barrel of pressures of development coming from all directions to our little city that sits on a very shallow and fragile aquifer. The Blanco River is spring-fed, and as demands increase for the water that keeps the river flowing, we need support of TCEQ, the agency that is charged with the responsibility to protect those waters. A discharge permit for development upstream from our city would be devastating to us. And you can see the difference. This is below the discharge. Just another second. We've worked hard to find solutions to avoid discharge because it's the right thing to do. Please use your authority to show that you have the backs of smaller cities like ours and be our partner in protecting these remaining fragile streams and rivers, not only for their environmental health, but for the health of our rural communities that depend on them for our economic well-being. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Devine.
Randy Shillette.
Yes, good morning. Thank you, Commissioners, for hearing this issue. This runs near and dear to our heart. I represent the Texas On-Site Wastewater Association. We have over 600 members. And as we agree with TCEQ on many, many issues, on this particular one, we do disagree with the executive director simply because on-site wastewater technologies are proven. We have over 2.3 million operating on-site systems in the state of Texas under 285, and many more under Chapter 217, because there's a gray area in the between direct discharge and what we consider on-site wastewater treatment. We need to make a colossal shift in our mindset of how we treat wastewater and where we dispose of wastewater. Soil treats wastewater much better than any technology that we can have on top of advanced wastewater treatment that we're using in substandard soils today. And so I commend TCEQ on many of the advances in our rules that allow us to do these types of things, but we need to make this a much larger shift away from direct discharge permits. I live in Bridge City, Texas, Southeast Texas. I grew up fishing and swimming on Cowbio, shrimping in our Sabine Lake, being able to go up and pick up oysters along the shores of the lake and eat them. We're no longer able to do that. And a big reason for that is direct discharge from our cities that are not being regulated properly, or there's many more potential hazardous constituents in wastewater than we are currently testing for, such as nitrogen, medical constituents that harm us or have
that's
the potential.
Time.
You can go ahead and finish up. Were you done, or do you need another moment,
well,
sir?
We have the technology. We can expand that technology. In fact, we've actually petitioned you guys for 32 petitions, and one of those petitions that we were considering was raising it from 5,000 to 10,000 gallon per day for on-site wastewater systems under 285 rules. But we realize and recognize that we've got to go back to the legislature to get that done. And on-site wastewater is growing. It needs to be accepted more widely for much larger systems than what we're currently using them for. and I'll yield my time to anyone else. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
John Byram.
Good morning, Mr. Byram.
Good morning. Good morning. I am John Byram, and I appear to you before you today as a Class A water and a Class A wastewater operator of the state of Texas, granted by the TCEQ. Thank you. I'm also executive director of the Nueces River Authority. Over the 42 years that I've been in utility management, you don't get this pretty by not managing utilities, I'll tell you. I've learned that it's not an easy task, and I sympathize with you. I know it's not easy, but I also know there's not 60 permits that are going to be affected by this. There are none in the Nueces Basin. There are no discharge permits in the Nueces Basin that flow into the pristine streams. I know firsthand that all the creeks, streams, and rivers in Texas are not the same. Each have unique attributes. Not all streams are suitable for direct discharge of wastewater. The one rule, one model, which TCEQ now has in place, it just flat doesn't work. All streams identified in this petition are streams that have undetectable phosphorus, and they will indeed be destroyed if they're discharged into. TLAP is the only management, the only way to manage that effluent in those areas. And the city of Lakey built a plant, NRA built a plant there by using funds from the SRF, and it is the prime example of a TLAP permit that works and works well. We see no reason to destroy the remaining pristine streams in Texas. The Nueces River Authority endorses a rule change here, and we would ask that you pass this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
William Martin.
Mr. Martin.
Hi, this is Bill Martin. I live along Long Branch Creek, which is a pristine stream that meets the terms of this rule change. I won't go into my written comments. I really wanted to talk to the commission about an issue that came up a year ago before the discharge permit was withdrawn by the applicant. And when I saw the, this was for a discharge about 6 miles upstream that would have affected the creek that we own, because it's one of those creeks that's less than 20 feet wide, so we actually own the bed of it. What I wanted to point out was that when I got the draft permit and looked at the phosphorus limits, I saw they were 0.16, and I don't know anything about water quality, so I thought that doesn't sound bad. Then I looked at the data of...
Excuse me, Mr. Martin, we need to not discuss details of pending permits because the commission...
If it's pending, it's gone, it's a done deal. You know, I tried to make that clear.
I got you. My question was, this is pending, and I mean, this is no longer pending. It's a closed deal we can talk about, was going to be my question for you, Ms. Smith. So I think we're okay. I don't think this raises ex parte concerns.
No,
okay.
It's good.
If it's no longer pending, it's fine.
Brought it up if it was pending.
Yeah, sorry for the interruption, Mr. Martin. Yeah, go ahead, please.
Okay, yeah, I don't want to run out of time here.
We'll extend your time.
Thank you. My point was that, yeah, I looked at the limits and thought, well, that looks okay. But when I looked at the actual analysis of the water and saw it was the natural limits were 0.01, I thought, why is TCEQ allowing this guy to dump 16 times the natural level of phosphorus into the creek? And at the public hearing, someone else brought that up, asked that question. And what I want to get across here is that the permit reviewers basically said the gist of it was, well, we just made an educated guess, and that seemed like the right amount. And I mean, that's what I thought when I looked at the permit, but I have absolutely no knowledge of water quality. So I thought that was a real problem. I work for an agency that I supervise several reviewers, some of which review these permits. And if one of my reviewers made that comment in a public meeting, I would pull them aside and have a conversation with them. And it wouldn't be, don't say that again in a public meeting because it makes us look bad. It would be, you need to come up with a rational reason based on analysis of data and present it in terms that a layman can understand, because that is the purpose of a public meeting. So I'm asking the commissioners to work with the executive director and the head of the water quality division to try and improve the way in which some of these limits are set. And we're not going to stop the discharge permits, so let's at least get them to where they make sense and discharge fewer nutrients into the creeks. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Stephanie Ryder Morris.
Ms. Morris, good morning.
Good morning. I'm Stephanie Ryder Morris, native Texan, asking you to please vote yes on the Pristine Streams petition. I live on the South San Gabriel River below the outfall where 1.2 million gallons a day of the strictest wastewater discharge permit in the entire state of Texas pours into the South San Gabriel River. I am not here about that permit. I am here to show the effects of even the strictest permit on pristine streams like the South San Gabriel. I am here for the river and here to prevent families upstream, downstream, and across the state from experiencing the horrific effects of dumping beneficial nutrients in the... Where's my PowerPoint?
Well, you've got some great PowerPoint standing on either side of you. Okay. We may be missing part of it, but...
I stayed up the entire night, Ron.
We'll get to it. We'll look at it.
I think before we... there are portions of the PowerPoint that contain information that could be used or could be about pending enforcement complaints, and so they can't be shown.
I have been involved in this system. I have been before you guys for 8 years. 8 years in the different phases of this system, and you are our only hope. I am stuck on my property because of the conditions of our property. I am not here about that permit. I am here to show the effects of even the strictest permit on pristine streams. Again, where's my... You won't show any of the PowerPoint?
There are portions that contain information.
Like the South San Gabriel, I am here for the river and here to prevent families upstream, downstream, and across the strait from experiencing horrific effects of dumping beneficial nutrients in the wrong place at the wrong time. Effects that our family has lived with for over 8 years. This is 200 yards. The front beautiful picture, which has nothing to do with the case, is 200 yards upstream of the wastewater. We have to get in our cars, load up the trailer, drive, park, and haul kayaks to enjoy the same river that we used to enjoy in our own backyard. We drive to get away from the sight and stench of our own section of river, our private property. We're escaping our property because of this permit, because of the strictest permit ever. Our slice of God's creation, which we try to be good stewards of. Slide two, next slide. The top picture is the South San Gabriel, clean and clear 100 yards upstream of the outfall. Note the red star at upper, marking the upper outfall. Mid picture, where clean water turns green after effluent runs down 60 feet of riverbank, unmarked, no signs. Children play in the effluent directly. Bottom pick, stinky, unusable acre of our backyard under the river. In the shade of trees is our second floor barn dominium overlooking the river 70 feet away. We see this all day, every day, out our bedroom and living room windows. Our bees will not drink from this water. Next slide, three. I have tens of thousands of similar photos over the last 8 years. But skip to this past Sunday, which actually represents stellar wastewater treatment and over 3 months of effluent averaging less than half of the total monthly phosphorus required in the strictest permit, half of 0.15 milligrams per liter. This is what 0.07 milligrams a liter looks like. This river is telling us it cannot handle even the best Texas water wastewater effluent. The sky is blue. The river is green. It stinks. It is disgusting. Every single one of these stream segments in this petition, less than 1% of the stream segments that remaining in our state that are still relatively clean. There are other pressures. Don't get us wrong. We know there are other pressures. They will look like my yard. They will look like this. TCEQ told us we shouldn't be in our own property. We go out to clean up algae out of the river. They are treating their wastewater on our private property, and y'all are rubber stamping it. They told us we shouldn't be in the river. It's hard to get them out there to investigate. I understand y'all are busy, you're understaffed, you're underpaid, you're not funded. We can't get people out there to investigate. So this is when we were told that this level of algae, that TCEQ doesn't enforce algae blooms. That's what I was told. I have had to fight for years to get them to even come look maybe once a year at what's happening. And yet, they told me when they saw a picture I had sent that I didn't have rubber boots and rubber gloves on, that we shouldn't be in that river on our own damn property without rubber boots and rubber gloves on below that effluent. Because they said wastewater treatment plants, even when they're run well, they have hiccups. They shart. So they told me they don't come investigate solids unless there are hundreds of yards of 8-inch deep solids, which hasn't happened in a while. I'm saying this plant has been functioning pretty damn well lately, and it's still a mess.
I'll ask you to wrap it up here, Ms. Morris.
The bottom line here, please understand, these cities are doing the best that they can with, they're not going to change what they're doing. They're not going to justify to their constituents to spend the money to do the right and honorable and ethical thing if the state doesn't tell them that they have to. So I'm not saying Town Lake, I'm not saying every river, I'm saying these rivers that are low flow and almost no phosphorus. Don't, this wastewater does not belong in these rivers and damn sure not on our private property. Thank you, sir. I'm sorry. I was so rude.
I understand why this is an emotional issue, and you're entitled to that. So I appreciate your comments, and it's good for us to hear the emotion behind it as well.
Went through the SOA process in 2014 too. So this isn't my first go around. So that's why having my stuff cut off because. Like,
thank you. And Ms. Smith, would it be possible for us to redact that so that the commission can see the slides that do not create an ex parte problem? Maybe we can sidebar with our legal team to make an effort to do that.
That's the problem.
It's the dates. Yes, because we don't want to jeopardize a future enforcement action.
And Liberty Hill has been in an enforcement action ever since.
And Ms. Morris, we can't. The commission can't hear about a contested item because it creates ex parte issues for us, and we may not. It may jeopardize our ability to take an enforcement action if we violate the ex parte prohibition. So
people can't even come out and investigate new complaints while there's an enforcement action too. These enforcement actions last 2 years, one day of an issue takes 2 years. And so that's 2 years that y'all won't come out and investigate. That's 2 years we're not allowed to talk about.
Ms. Smith, would you ask legal counsel to review the PowerPoint deck and determine whether we can redact parts of it so that the commission can see it?
I believe that we could redact the dates, but I'm not sure that we could do it in the course of this meeting. So we could show it to you. I mean, we can do our best. I just don't think that I have someone here with Acrobat to redact it. And I'm not sure that we have a printer here, but let me work on it and I'll do my best.
Okay. All right. Well, we're going to, if we
can, I ask Ms. Smith a question just to clarify my understanding. I'm not an attorney, so I want to make sure I understand our agency's limitations here. I believe that any of those particular pictures could potentially be a piece of evidence that you may require to find justice down the road for new violations, open violations, and so showing it before us today could entirely invalidate that future looking enforcement application. And if that is my understanding, I think I if that's accurate, then hopefully you can see why we don't want to prevent you from getting justice at a later point for open actions that are still occurring today. Is that generally accurate?
That's accurate.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. Appreciate it.
I won't do to other people what has been done to us. And the people who live for miles up and down these rivers, they deserve not to have to have gone through the hell that we've gone through. So yes, I understand. I may be throwing myself and ending up with more discharge at our actual already existing plant if we ban discharges. I understand that. Biting off my nose to spite my face.
Thank you.
That's why I'm here, because it matters.
Thank you, Ms. Morris. Ms. Smith, will you call the next interested person, please?
Mr. Robert Morris.
You got this. This is going to be good. Thank you for being here.
My name is Robert Morris. I'm 12 years old and I go to Danielson Middle School in Leander, Texas. I have a river in my backyard. Most would say that was cool, but then they come and see the river. It's nasty brown and green mixture of wastewater and algae. When we first moved here, the water was clean. Slowly it started to get dirtier, but every now and then we had a flood that cleared it out for a few weeks. But lately there haven't been anything close to any floods, resulting in an outburst of algae. Though it may not look like it, after living like this for years, it changes a person. My mom has become a kooky environmentalist. After seeing, smelling, and living like this. So I hope we can keep our rivers clean, hopefully.
Thank you, Mr. Morris. Thank you, sir. Ms. Smith, will you call the next person, please?
Carol Hawkins.
Hi.
Good morning.
I'm Carol Hawkins. I am Stephanie's mom and Robert's proud grandmother. And I, too, have become a kooky environmentalist, seeing what this has done to my family, that we cannot use the river that we love so much and was the reason they moved there those years ago. I want you to know that Joe Moore, who wrote the 1975 Clean Water Act, was my friend. Joe became a member of the LBJ administration and moved from Austin to Washington, D.C., where he stayed through the early 90s, protecting our environment. This is our law. He wrote it. Our law would protect us more than we're seeing here if it were enforced. After serving at a national level, Joe moved back to Texas and to Austin, where he became a deacon in our church, First Baptist downtown. And he built the program at Texas State in ecology. The Environmental Protection Agency funds TCEQ to uphold this law, but the law is not upheld. And you see some of the thousands of pictures that we have that demonstrate that the most strict water quality license in Texas does not protect these streams. Joe would have been terribly disappointed with what we're not able to show you today and what we have been able to show you. I also want you to know my husband is a retired TCEQ engineer, so I know what you all are up against. I know that you're lobbied by the big bucks and that a lot of TCEQ employees are depressed because they're not allowed to protect the environment they came to work here to protect.
That's time.
Go ahead and take your time to finish
up. I just want to say that for the sake of God and Joe Moore, I'm pleading with you to do what you're here to do.
Thank you, Ms. Hawkins.
Valerie Erickson.
Ms. Erickson. Let's come back.
Andrew Engelke.
Morning, sir.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, fellow commissioners. My name is Andrew Engelke. I live at South Gabriel Drive in Leander. I'm just upstream from Ms. Morris's property. I've owned the property since 2015. In the interest of full disclosure, I've been named as an affected party in an ongoing hearing with the SOA. Because of my proximity to the actual outflow point from the City of Liberty Hills water treatment plant. So every day my wife and I go down to the river that used to flow cleanly and past our property and see the algae bloom that develops immediately at the outflow site and actually comes upstream because it is such a low flow, almost no flow river at times. So we not only see it, but I hear it. I hear the water falling, the discharge falling into the river, and I smell it. So, and it has affected our ability uniquely because our property is located so close to it, our ability to wade in the water, to swim in the water, to fish in the water. In fact, the fish have gone away. There are no more fish there. And the crawfish are gone as well. We used to have a lot of crawfish in the evenings, and they're gone as well. And I attribute it, it's all occurred since the outflow started there. So I'm using this, I'm here in support of the petition and the broader petition. I'm just using my case as an example of what occurs, just as Ms. Morris was, what occurs to a pristine river when sewage is basically treated and then allowed to be dumped into that river, even with the strictest of standards. It's visually evident, it's sensorily evident to anybody, even the casual observer who were to come down there. It's common sense, it's good conscience. I am here in full support of the petition. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
David Price.
Mr. Price.
Good afternoon, commissioners. Thank y'all for taking the time. My background is a little varied. I'm actually the president of the Texas Rivers Protection Association. Now that may sound odd, but oddly enough, I design, build, and operate wastewater plants. Okay, a little odd thing here is that the plants that we do are all zero discharge. Some of the areas from which y'all may be familiar is Camp Eagle up on the headwaters of the Nueces River. My company took an existing system that was under a TCEQ violation, and we made that a zero discharge system. The algae, which people are speaking about in the river, disappeared after it was washed away in a flood. As has been mentioned, the very thing which is attracting people to this area is the very thing that's going to be destroyed if wastewater discharges occur. As y'all may know, the background levels that are measured actually by TCEQ are 0.006 milligrams per liter. To put that in perspective, you convert that to parts per billion, that's 6 parts per billion of phosphorus. Now, what happens is it only takes a doubling of that amount to cause nuisance algae. Now, what happens with this nuisance algae, it destroys the dissolved oxygen levels in the water. This affects the fish. This affects all what's called benthic organisms and pretty much all the aquatic life in there. As y'all have heard from other people, this is devastating to the use of the river. I have personal experience in this, a piece of property I own, the San Gabriel River. I had extreme difficulty selling because of the algae issue. Our group, Texas River Protection, Rivers Protection Association, is not anti-development. All we are asking for is consideration and approval of this petition to simply maintain the pristine character of these streams. Texas has over 191,000 miles of streams and rivers, and we would ask that these be protected by approval of this.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Lawan Toll.
Mr. Toll?
Mrs.
Toll. I'm sorry.
Hello, can you hear me now?
We've got you, yes. Good morning.
Oh, am I audio only?
You are audio only. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. All
but right. You look Thank fantastic.
You. Well, this is the way to do it.
I'll tell you.
I live on the South San Gabriel River, and I'm here to support this petition. you've heard from my neighbors up and down the river, Stephanie Morris. What she says is absolutely true. We moved here in 2007. We're actually between 3 and 4 miles from the outflow of the Liberty Hill Wastewater Treatment Plant. And the algae and the mats and the dead fish, all of that has totally taken away our usage of the river. The same pool on our property that we were baptized with our grandchildren and held subsequent baptisms, we can no longer even get in the water. There's been so many violations ongoing. Nothing changes unless, like young Master Morris said, there's a heavy rain. Do we ever get a reprieve? I implore you, the committee, to please protect those that aren't fighting the battle that we're having to fight right now, and save our streams. For Texas, you don't have to live on a water, a river. You don't have to live on a river to enjoy the benefits of clean groundwater. We have a well. There's contamination that's highly possible because of this wastewater. There are alternatives. Reuse is an alternative, and it works. Please protect Texas further. I'm a native. Thank you for the time.
Thank you, ma'am.
We've gone through the list. Do you want to go back through
Yes.
Paul DiFiore.
Mr. DiFiore. Why don't we move on?
Peter Cross.
Mr. Cross.
Good morning. Can you hear me?
We can. Yeah. Yes. Good morning. Okay. Just barely. Good morning, sir. Go ahead.
Okay. I'm talking this morning to ask you to approve the petition, talking on behalf of myself, but more importantly, talking on behalf of my one-month-old granddaughter, Lainey. It's very important that we keep pristine streams in Texas. There are proven practical options that which will allow development. There are so many demonstrations to say that the damage is done is extreme and predictable. If it's allowed, it's going to ruin these streams. Please approve the petition.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Smith?
Valerie Erickson.
Ms. Erickson? Let's move on.
Jeff Wiles.
Mr. Wiles. Let's move on.
Jackson Cassidy.
Mr. Cassidy. Is that it?
That's it, and I understand that we may have some redacted copies of Ms. Morris's presentation.
Thank you for redacting the presentation so that we can see what we're able to see. Ms. Morris, we'll take just a minute to look through the presentation up here. And colleagues, feel free to ask Ms. Morris any questions if you have any.
We y'all be accessing the color copy electronically at some point?
No, I have just got the color copy, and I can send it to these two who have their computers, and I'll see if the chairman wants to look over my shoulder.
Yeah, let me do that.
I keep interrupting y'all. It just doesn't mean much without the green.
No, you're right to raise that point. We can't see the blue and the blue and the green. So
it looks like white limestone. This is what it should look like.
I can see the shadow of the kayak on the bottom of the water course, though, which says something. So I'm going
to
look
Chairman,
over.
I'm trying to get it on the projector for you. 1 second.
Okay. Thank you.
Sorry. Yeah.
Ms. Morris, thank you for putting together the presentation. I was able to view it in color. I enjoyed the pterodactyl slide. I agree, not kooky, I hear you. Colleagues, let me know when you're ready to continue. Okay. Okay. All right, well, I think we're at a point where I'd like to share my thoughts on this matter. Oh.
We did.
Yeah, OPIC went before our interested persons. Yeah. Yeah. He only gets once. First, I want to correct a notion that I saw in some of the reporting on this topic, and that's the idea that the commission can here today adopt or promulgate the rule in the petition. And that's incorrect. Any rule would have to go through a normal Administrative Procedures Act rulemaking process. So our options today are either to initiate a rulemaking or deny the petition. And if we initiate a rulemaking, that doesn't guarantee any particular outcome. So I just want to be clear about what a petition for rulemaking is and how it works. Next, I'll state the obvious. The water segments at issue here are state treasures, and we all have an obligation to protect them. I also want to talk about the agency's current approach to regulation. I want to acknowledge that the agency does have a longstanding monitoring program. I think the petition relies on that data, 10 years worth of data. It informs our regulation of nutrients in state waters, and that's part of a broad effort that includes monitoring of total nitrogen and phosphorus, as well as water quality indicators such as chlorophyll A and dissolved oxygen. TCEQ has also developed sampling procedures to monitor periphyton, which is associated with phosphorus levels. And the agency continues to conduct and evaluate studies to inform the development of our nutrient criteria, which supports regulation through Texas's surface water quality standards and Texas's TIPD's permitting program, And this is all consistent with state law and the Federal Clean Water Act. The procedures to implement the Texas surface water quality standards include screening procedures to protect surface waters from nutrient impacts. So Texas's scientific and technical work are part of a dynamic legal and regulatory framework for addressing nutrient pollution. And that's true for waters across the state, and it is also true for the regulation of phosphorus in the waters identified in the petition. So in a nutshell, that is Texas's response to the problem of nutrient pollution. And of course, the broader question is whether Texas's response is enough protection for these low phosphorus segments or zero phosphorus segments. And that is certainly the aim of our surface water quality standards. And it is it's critical that we remain focused on that question. The petitioners tell us, and the commenters overwhelmingly have told us, we've heard from them this morning, that program is not enough. And they urge us to ban discharges to these segments. And they suggest that land application, reuse, and septic systems are appropriate alternatives. And colleagues, it's particularly hard for me to say this after hearing the testimony this morning, but y'all are gonna need to keep fighting this. I can't vote to solve your problem today. My colleagues may have a different opinion. These are just mine. It's one vote. But I can't get behind this particular solution, at least not now. And I want to explain why. I do have some questions about whether it's an appropriate solution. That is, whether the scale of the solution fits the needs to the particular water course, whether it's the best way to interdict phosphorus, whether land application and reuse and septic are indeed superior environmental solutions. Based on the testimony this morning, I have reason to believe that they very well may be or are better solutions. But that aside, my overriding concern is that this rule would be a seismic policy change for this agency. And the proper role for an executive branch agency is, in my view, and it's an opinion that I've expressed in several different forms, is to do gap filling policy to implement legislation, and not to take on sweeping policy changes, but to leave that to the legislature. And the outright banning of discharges on hundreds of miles of Texas rivers and streams is the kind of large bore policy that we should leave to the legislature. Now, this proposal in a somewhat similar form, it's pared down here, has been before the legislature, and I want to address the relevance of that. The executive director and at least one commenter suggest that the legislature's inaction indicates a legislative intent that the agency not initiate rulemaking. And I'm not quite sure what they meant by that, but it is not a valid statement of law. The legislature expresses its intent through acts, such as statutes, and here there is no act, there's no statute to bar the agency from initiating this rulemaking. So colleagues, for me, this is not a question of whether we have the authority. I think we do have the authority. It's a question of our proper exercise of that authority. And again, I don't believe that initiating this rulemaking would be a proper exercise of our authority. I am sensitive to the threat that phosphorus poses to Texas waters. Even more so, having prepared for this meeting and educated myself more about it, and even greater so hearing the testimony this morning. So I am very receptive to efforts including efforts within our existing framework to quantify and address the issue. And developers who wish to discharge to these waters should not be surprised by the fight that they're going to run into. They should not be surprised by stringent limits. And they should expect to hear from the same people in this room, our petitioners and our commenters, back here before the dais, challenging their applications. And I think, at least for me, they're going to run into a fairly receptive audience. So unfortunately, I think, at least where I am, is that we're going to have to continue to engage in those fights. That is likely our future together, all of us. So although I don't intend to require it, I would encourage and welcome and be grateful for developers who bring us forward-thinking, no-discharge solutions. I think the city of Blanco and Lakey are on their way to being models of that. I would encourage anybody who wants to apply for a discharge permit to first take a good look at what those cities are doing. I think that can pay dividends in a number of ways. We heard testimony about water quality, the quality of drinking water. I would add drought resiliency to that. That certainly sounds like a better future for me. So anyway, colleagues, those are my comments. And Commissioner Lindley, let me turn it over to you.
Thanks. You stated a lot of things very, very well. I will make the comment that we did hear from a lot of commenters today, but we didn't hear from all of them. And while written comments carry just as much weight, I'm genuinely shocked that the people that opposed this did not show up today to voice their concerns. So I'll just say that. That aside, that doesn't influence my decision making, but I struggled with this one a lot too. I haven't been to all those sections of the rivers named in the petition, but I've been to a few, and they are lovely. I don't take lightly the precedent we would be setting if we were to grant this rulemaking, either moving forward or eventually. And where I've come down is I'm in agreement with you. This is a heavy, heavy policy lift. And what I can't get over is how the legislature has handled it in the past. And personal opinions aside, I'm not willing today to get in front of them on this policy issue. There was a comment made, and it just so everyone knows where I'm kind of coming from, it weighed heavily on me, and it talked about how, you know, this is on the record, so I feel like I can say this so I don't misquote it. It actually was from Representative Larson, former Representative Larson. And his explanation opposing his opposition to House Bill 817, and he had stated that, there's treated effluent in waterways that serves other purposes like irrigation. It chops transport usable water for potentially drinking water for folks downstream. And so I just try and think of things in a really big way. And so I don't know, that really weighed on me. And so that's why I'm not comfortable today, I'll just put it that way, adopting a policy that would open up a pathway to a potential ban. And I'll stop there. It's a very, very hard decision.
Thank you, Commissioner Lindley. Commissioner Janeka.
Well, I feel that while the authority does rest with our agency, we would be a little derelict not to exercise a sincere inquiry into how and to where we could use our existing authority. And so to that end, I think I'm in favor of voting to initiate rulemaking of some sort, knowing and recognizing exactly what you made in your first point, Chairman, that our rulemaking process is long and open-ended and has very unclear and unsatisfying deadlines for the public in terms of what their expectations would look like on the other end. And oftentimes, initiated rulemakings come out looking very differently, where we propose them as viable proposals within the framework of that broad and very convoluted regulatory framework in which we operate. I think that the legislature has some cheerleaders and some opponents to this issue and to this sort of policy intervention, and I am troubled by the prospect of our agency voting to advance the rulemaking, and we find ourselves in short order being told firmly and clearly by the legislature, not only do you not need to do that, but now you have less authority than you did yesterday. And I take that very seriously. I don't want to erode any of the existing authorities that our agency has, but neither do I find any satisfaction in us holding them and not utilizing them to the fullest extent that we can. And so I'd be in support of instructing the executive director to explore not rulemaking necessarily following the strict substance of the petition before us, because I certainly agree with your point, and I think the points you raised by Chairman Larson were spot on. Where we hold the authority and have exercised it, really it's for captive aquifer systems where those limitations or bans really tied into the captive and low recharging conditions of that water system. Well, this is a different approach, taking a more qualitative definition-based, wherever there is very low phosphorus. I find a lot of compelling arguments for our agency trying to make a designation of what are pristine waters and what additional protections or what additional requirements or tests would be appropriate for the private sector applicants seeking to obtain a discharge permit into those waterways. I think we could raise the bar. I don't know how much, and I don't find that the proposal before us would be an appropriate or anything less than a very blunt application of that sort of a control. But that's where I'm at, and I think that there's a lot of flexibility we have in how much we direct and instruct the executive director to explore issues before us. So I'm not uncomfortable with the prospect of a denial vote on the issue before us today. But I certainly intend to continue a discussion with the executive director in trying to better understand this issue, and really getting deeper into the idea around nutrient pollution and where health impacts in our agency's policing, strict policing of those health impacts of constituents being introduced into our state's waterways. Where are there other impacts that aren't captured under our regulatory process that we may try to broaden and build in a little more appropriate incentives into our process that helps nudge developers? And I want to recognize there are a broad number of tools that we haven't even fully explored or touched on today in the comments before us. Funding from the State Revolving Fund for the creation or construction of infrastructure along our waterways is a critical and very important tool that our state has available to us. And we're in the process of trying to digest and assign out a large bit of federal money coming down for exactly these sorts of resources and infrastructures. So on that side of the policy equation, where we can build in incentives or encouragements to developers or communities that seek to use those funds to hopefully find more of our communities in Texas and our entities landing in a place where we have zero discharge or more creative solutions that help protect these pristine waters. All that said, I think there's a vote count that seems to be clear here, and I would just welcome your thoughts on what appetite or concerns you have at the prospect of trying to give some encouragement to Executive Director to explore these issues further, not necessarily in the context of a rulemaking vote in that regard, but perhaps at another discussion another time.
Commissioner Lindley?
I don't know off the top of my head. I mean, I don't think I'm going to put words in your mouth, so feel free to correct me, but I don't think any one of us love the idea of the potential of what could happen to any of these rivers. No one does. No one in this room wants that. We would all agree these are gems that our state has. You know, off the top of my head, I just don't know all the tools necessary. I do agree there probably are some tools that the executive director has that we need to explore and really, really look into that just already exist, that we already have the authority that can use, that can be used and implemented should we get an application for a discharge permit. I don't know off the top of my head. I'm not against, I guess your idea is to, you know, explore maybe stricter guidelines. I don't know. I don't want to use the wrong word, but that could potentially be put into a permit that would be more protective. And Earl's wanting to say something.
Commissioners, if I could just interject. We have explored this issue, and you know, we take the concerns very seriously. And from the executive director standpoint, we have initiated a rule change to allow for a simultaneous application for a TLAP permit as well as a 210 reuse. So we are working on that, and that's kind of an incentive to applicants to look at alternative options. Additionally, we're exploring the consideration of a TLAP general permit for certain areas of the state, if that would be appropriate. Again, that would be an incentive to look at land application rather than discharge. So I just wanted to share that, some things that we're currently initiating.
Thank you, Mr. Lott.
I want to ask about a comment that we heard about the basis for determining nutrient values or phosphorus values. I don't want to take us off the posted agenda, but I am curious if that is a point that we've looked at or may need to explore how to better provide a clear identification of the factors and the process by which our agency permit reviewers determine and recommend values in those permits.
I will start off, Commissioner, and then I will ask Greg Easley to kind of add to that. But with these permits, we do look at background levels, and we consider assimilative accumulation. And basically, we factor in things like water depth, water flow, water temperature, as well as canopy cover when making these determinations. And Greg, let me ask if you have anything else to add.
Yeah, Greg Easley with Water Quality Division. I would just add that, you know, our procedures, specifically our procedures to implement the Texas Surface Water Quality Standards, direct us to take into consideration the things that Earl mentioned, but it also, you know, directs us to consider, you know, reasonably achievable, you know, technology limits or limitations. So without going into its specifics, I mean, that's another factor that we have to throw into the mix.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And I heard several factors that all seemed less static and potentially dynamic, where water flow or tree cover could, over the life of a permit, actually change. Are there any acknowledgement of that dynamic quality built into the permits, where if any of those underlying conditions start to change, are there clear vehicles by which members of the public or perhaps the applicant may have their permit conditions changed to make sure that they meet changing conditions to keep a reasonable nutrient limitation in the permit?
Yes, absolutely. You know, we have the flexibility to, you know, each time a permit comes back before us to reconsider changes and conditions on the ground, you know, site-specific conditions, such as what you mentioned.
With what frequency do those permits return back before us?
Typically, it's a five-year interval, but it can sometimes be less depending on, you know, other circumstances.
Can you recall, without naming specifics, can you recall examples where we have reduced and on subsequent actions of a permit renewing or extending, change those controls?
Yes, I can.
Okay. I think that's helpful to me to hear of some of the tools that we have existing to us today that as Mr. Lott alludes to, we can certainly revisit and better articulate how we can continue to utilize them effectively.
Let me try to refocus the conversation if I can. It sounds like we are unanimous on denial because we don't want to... Maybe not. I'm sorry.
I don't think I'm entirely comfortable voting to deny the petition, but
okay.
Thank you.
That's me.
That's fair. I mean, that's fair. And we need to hash this out. Here's what I'm thinking. In my mind, I'm uncomfortable exercising this agency's authority in a way that is quite that bold. And so I don't want to initiate a rulemaking process because I don't want to give the petitioners the expectation or the hope that that's where I'm going to be at the end of this, because I think that is highly unlikely. On the other hand, a rulemaking process, we enter into those without knowing where they will lead, and a rulemaking process would provide a forum for bringing stakeholders together and sharing ideas and hammering out solutions. I am, for the reasons I stated again, against suggesting that I'm ready to adopt a ban right now. I do think that we should be talking about, well, absent a ban, I think it's incumbent on this agency to make sure that our existing authorities and programs work. And I appreciate the testimony today, but we've got to make them work and figure out how to make them work and not let them fail these stream segments. That's a big undertaking to understand the problems and the different water courses. I mean, banning is simple. I think for myself, I've ruled that out. It could present other problems. It may not be the appropriate solution. Maybe it is. We don't know that. I don't know that. But what I'm getting at is I feel like it would be very helpful to have a stakeholder process to work through these issues in an effort to try to make our programs work. So what I thought you were getting at is a suggestion to deny this petition, but on your own motion, initiate another rulemaking. Ms. Smith, I assume that would be, since it's the same topic, would be fairly noticed on this petition for rulemaking.
I'd like to discuss with my assistant general counsels before I make a recommendation on that.
Or if it's not that process, another forum, not to study this to death, but to triage, identify solutions, educate the landowners who have designs to apply for discharge permits, let them talk with the folks at Leakey and Blanco and whatever the solutions are, and I think they're going to be, probably multifaceted, provide a forum for that. So anyway, I don't know what the next step is, whether it's a different rulemaking process or work that we can do through the nutrient criteria work group. I don't have a solution to that I can offer today.
Likewise. And I want to just add one point. I appreciate the comment, and you reminded me of an earlier aspect of Chairman Larson's correspondence that I also wanted to raise, and that was it identifies several crucial tools that I think a ban would deprive us of in circumstances we really sincerely may need them in the future. And so for that reason, I'm in agreement with you that a ban, an outright ban, is not the right answer in my view, because we may find ourselves in a future circumstance where a bed and banks authorization to deliver treated water from one community to another, where we're in a circumstance of our collective Texas consternation at that point in time is over tremendous drought, and we need water in a community that has no water, and the only way to get it there is to provide it along a bed and banks authorization that would appear to be entirely prohibited and off the table under the rule proposal. And so I think that is too clear and too obvious of a very good example not to embark in that direction. I will add a little more clarification on my thought process behind not wanting to deny today. I think I don't see that our It's not clear to me how a vote otherwise binds us in any way to the substance of the proposal in terms of a ban, and I share your reservations about our agency being seen as too aggressive in wanting to create new programs or exert new authority. But in terms of material impacts of the vote and the outcome of it, I find it just a little too unpleasant to vote denial versus approving rulemaking and it comes back around and everything's impossible. I think that would be the one of the least satisfying outcomes we could find, but at least would help convince me that we had given it an earnest investigation into the prospect of a rulemaking and ED had considered it.
I have not just one thought I've been thinking of this whole time. It's just kind of an acknowledgement more than anything else, but I don't think it was directly said that today, but it was raised in comments that, you know, one issue that could arise should a wastewater treatment plant ever be along one of these 22 segments would be the issue of having qualified wastewater treatment operators. And that comment stuck out to me. I don't know if anyone would disagree that, yeah, that's something that this state has a problem with, and we've raised it. Just know that we have raised that with the legislature. There's a lot of people that are very, very concerned about that issue and are talking a lot right now about what does this state need to be doing to make sure we have qualified professionals that can run these operations. So that's different than the rule petition, but I just want y'all to know that is something that's come up before your rule petition. If you have thoughts, comments, I personally would love to hear them. I talk to the ledge a lot about that issue. Well, maybe not right now, but because we probably have to stay, you know, on point. But I just want to acknowledge that issue. This agency has raised it. We're trying to get creative and think of solutions and share those with whoever, because we recognize that's an issue for the future. So I just want to acknowledge that comment because I agree.
So Commissioner Janeka, what exactly are you proposing today?
I was just going to skate by on the fact that y'all were apparently both going to vote denial and it didn't make a material difference for me not to vote deny. I will ask the executive director staff that they could commit to by the end of April, scheduling a visit with me in my office to help explain to me what the basis, the real limits of our tools in this space, where we have clear factors that we utilize in considering permits that come before us, where there's any difference between our evaluation for streams that would meet a pristine water definition versus other waterways, where we have any flexibility in our agency's discretion, where we're currently using that or aren't. And that's a very broad ask. I think that that's really the level of investigation I'm interested before I can better educate myself in what direction we would need to go further. I'll fill the airspace with one last point that I think is worth mentioning here. As a public policy issue of this request before us, I want to acknowledge the use it or lose it aspect of those pristine streams. If the state of Texas doesn't act either from action by the legislature, from action by our agency, from action by the good communities who are being leaders by example and leading by action. I've heard the city of Lakey a couple of times today, and really the Blanco council member, I appreciate and I commend you and your fellow council members in your public service, but also in leading by example and taking that hard decision to look at, explore more costly development that prevents that direct discharge into the rivers. Unless we act, the unintended consequence of the Texas miracle that is driving a tremendous population movement into our state from across the country and the world, we're going to find an opportunity lost. We will move down the road and look back and find development has moved on and we've sunk costs left and right, and we can't unravel from that point in time. We can't unring the bell. And for that reason, I just want to make sure that we've taken a sincere and full and complete look at what we need to articulate as the expert agency responsible for this policy space to the legislature I'm very sensitive as a former legislative staffer just how little opportunity we really have to sit down and understand and explore all of the technical complexities of the issues that we deal with and make quick proclamations, relatively quick decisions and proclamations from the state leadership perspective down into the depths of the agencies where we do that work. And if our agency is not trying to utilize our resources to explore that and articulate back to the legislature how and where they should be using their authority or enhancing our authority to do that better, I'd be remiss that we missed an opportunity.
Certainly appreciate those comments. You should vote your conscience on this. I respect your vote, even when it's, and maybe especially when it's different from mine. I would like to see some kind of, you know, more than just a sidebar with staff in my office, some sort of a stakeholder process. And I don't know if a rulemaking process is the right tool for that or not. But what I might suggest is that we put an item on our next agenda to have the executive director come back to us with ideas about what that stakeholder process might look like. In the interim, the petitioners and commenters and the developers who commented who are not here today can visit with staff to share their ideas of what that stakeholder process ought to look like. And I think the aim is get this right under our existing authorities or figure out what authorities we still need and make those recommendations to the legislature.
I'd be very supportive of that stakeholder group.
Very much supportive, yeah.
Okay, so, and I'm sorry we've got to cut off the comments, sir. I'm sorry, but I would encourage you to visit with staff. I think what we're going to do is just instruct staff from the dais to take your phone calls to develop ideas about what that stakeholder group would look like. I appreciate there's some urgency to this, so I'm not sure how to organize all of the work that's in front of us, but I'll leave that to the stakeholders. You're killing me. All right, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Brian Zobchik, and I'm with Save Barton Creek Association, and we're one of the petitioners. And I speak on behalf of all of the other petitioners and the commenters here, that we really hope that we have an opportunity to come back and talk to you, about this issue. We appreciate the opportunity to talk to Mr. Lott. We've already had meetings with Mr. Lott and other members of the staff. But we also, too, know that staff already has some of their thoughts formed on these issues. We also do know that the opponents, as Commissioner Lindley has alluded to, have their thoughts on that, and we respect that, too. We have a lot of replies to just the issues that y'all have brought up just now on the dais. And I think I speak for all of us is that we hope that we have an opportunity to address you again and soon on this issue, because we feel that there are a lot of questions that you have raised that we would like to contribute our answer to. Thank you.
All right, thank you, sir. Colleagues, I think we can commit to taking public comment on on this item at agenda whenever we're able to notice that. Commissioner Janeka has also invited folks to come visit with him, mm-hmm. sidebar in his office. I will do the same. Mm-hmm. My calendar is pretty full for the next several weeks. There may or may not be time to get in to see me in the next couple of weeks, but if it's at some point, you know, when we can make the scheduling work, I welcome that also before or after the next agenda where we're able to put this on the item, and I'll let Commissioner Lindley respond to any invitations to have meetings with her. But
Chairman, can I ask, is this, I appreciate the discussion, the suggestion that we hear further testimony at a future agenda date. Is this an appropriate item for discussion, and could we hear stakeholder feedback at an agency work session? I know that's usually designed for internal or more inward-facing dialogue, less public interfacing dialogue, but we've heard from some invited testimony in the past at work sessions. Is that an appropriate forum to go more into without eating into the decision-making
time? We could do that, too. I think I have a sense of urgency about forming a stakeholder process, so whether that's at...
Very good. I see.
And it's something that we need to notice. So whether we can notice that at a at an agenda, the next available agenda, or the next work session makes no difference to me. All right. So
I'll chime in real quick.
Yes.
My door is open as well. I'll just say that since before the day got away from me. I would have said before we closed out, and I think we're getting close to closing out at least, that I don't think this will be the last time we discuss this issue, whether it's the TCEQ or the legislature downtown. I wouldn't imagine that today would have, if we do, you know, deny the petition, would be the last time we'd talk about it. And I'm perfectly fine with that. So I can make a motion if we think we're to that point, but I don't want to cut anyone off.
I'd like to make...
Why don't we postpone?
Well, I'd like to make the motion.
Okay.
I don't want to postpone the motion because I think...
If I may, the petition must be heard by state statute within 60 days, so we wouldn't be able to continue it to the next agenda and meet that statutory deadline.
Forgot about that. Good point. It's nice to have lawyers. Does it expire by operation of law? Or we've failed to, never mind, not important. All right, we're going to act on this. I would like to read my own motion because I disagree with the order because of its language around legislative intent and the significance of that. So I have a different motion to offer. Colleagues, I move that we deny the petition for rulemaking concerning amendments to 30 Texas Administrative Code Chapter 311, that we issue the executive director's proposed order but modify the order to state a single reason for our denial as follows. TCEQ already addresses the concerns raised in the petition with a legally adequate program for assessing and protecting stream segments under the Texas Surface Water Quality Standards at 30 Texas Administrative Code Chapter 307 and the agency's TPD's permitting program. That's my motion. Is there a second?
Second.
The motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed say nay.
Nay.
The motion passes. Thanks, everybody, for participating today. This is clearly not the end of this conversation. We have additional items on this agenda, so anybody who wants to take off and leave for lunch, I'll give you a minute to do that, but we've got to continue on with our agenda.
Thank you all very much for consideration. I do wish to make sure that we fully participate in the continuing dialogue. There is no technology available. Your staff is wrong. Therefore, there is no option for technically treating the water and discharging it. It's that simple. And we have 1% left, and time is of the essence. Thank you all very much for your consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Goldman.
And your thoughts.
Look forward to talking about this again soon. Ms. Smith, please call the next item.
Item 21 is the consideration for publication of and hearing on proposed amended sections 299.1, 299.2, and 299.7 of 30 Texas Administrative Code, Chapter 299, regarding dams and reservoirs. The Executive Director's staff is here to present this item.
Mr. Samuelson, it is great to see you, sir. Go ahead when you're ready.
I should say good afternoon, Commissioners, General Counsel, and Public Interest Counsel. On behalf of the Executive Director, I'm Warren Samuelson with the Critical Infrastructure Division, and with me is Kelly Cook, and also with Harrison Malley with the Environmental Law Division. Consideration for publication of and hearing on proposed amended sections 299.1, 299.2, 299.7 of 30 TAC, Chapter 299, Dams and Reservoirs. The proposed rulemaking would implement Senate Bill 600 from the 87th Legislature 2021 regular session related to requiring river authorities to submit information on their dams. House Bill 2694, 82nd Legislature 2011, and House Bill 677, 83rd Legislature 2013 related to exemption of dams. The proposed rulemaking would also make revisions to clarify language in the rules. A public hearing will be offered on this proposal in Austin on May 17, 2022. Staff respectfully recommends approval to propose a publication of and hearing on Chapter 299 Dams and Reservoir. Staff also respectfully requests permission to make non-substantial revisions to comply with the Texas Register requirements. Thank you. We are available for any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Samuelson. I have none. Commissioner Lindley?
No questions.
Commissioner Janeka? Ms. Smith, has anyone signed in?
No.
Mr. McWhorter?
OPIC recommends approval for publication of and hearing on the proposed amendments to the Commission's Chapter 299 rules to implement Senate Bill 600 as presented by the Executive Director.
Thank you, colleagues. I agree. Pretty straightforward legislative implementation. Make sure our dams are maintained.
I agree. I've got a motion. I would move that we approve the publication of and hearing on proposed amendments to 30 Texas Administrative Code Chapter 299, Dams and Reservoirs, as recommended by the Executive Director.
The motion has been made. And?
I second.
And now seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. The motion carries. Mr. Samuelson, thank you. Good to see you, sir. Ms. Smith, please call the next item.
Item 22 is the adoption of the repeal of certain sections of 30 Texas Administrative Code, Chapter 308, related to critical standards for the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, 30 Texas Administrative Code, Section 314.1, related to toxic pollutant effluent standards, and 30 Texas Administrative Code, Section 315.1, related to pretreatment regulations for existing and new sources of pollution, and the adoption of new sections of 30 Texas Administrative Code, Chapter 305, regarding consolidated permits. The Executive Director's staff is here to present the item.
Good afternoon, Ms. Fleet.
Good afternoon, Commissioners, General Counsel, Public Interest Counsel. On behalf of the Executive Director, I'm Laurie Fleet with the Office of Water. With me today is Todd Gallagher with the Environmental Law Division. The rulemaking would repeal Chapters 308, 314, 315, and readopt these rules within Chapter 305, Subchapter P, with the exception of 308, Subchapter C and J, which will not be readopted because they were determined to be obsolete. Rulemaking would also adopt by reference 40 Code of Federal Regulations, Part 125, Subpart N. The proposed rulemaking was published in the Texas Register in October of 2021. The comment period ended in November of 2021, and no public comments were received. Staff respectfully request adoption of the proposed rule and authorization to make non-substantive changes to comply with Texas Register requirements. Thank you, and we're available for any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Fleet. I have none. Commissioner Lindley?
No questions.
Commissioner Janeka?
None for me.
No one signed in?
Correct.
Mr. McWhorter?
OPIC recommends adoption of the rulemaking to repeal obsolete rules and update other identified rules as presented by the Executive Director.
I agree. I'm ready to adopt this rule.
Me too.
I move that we adopt the repeal of Sections 30 Texas Administrative Code, Chapters 308, 314, and 315, and adopt new sections of 30 Texas Administrative Code, Chapter 305, as recommended by the Executive Director.
I second.
The motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. The motion carries. Ms. Smith, please call the next item.
Item 23 is the consideration for adoption of repealed sections of 30 Texas Administrative Code, Chapter 321, control of certain activities by rule, and Chapter 351 regarding regionalization. The Executive Director's staff is here to present the item.
And good afternoon again.
Hello again. On behalf of the Executive Director, I'm Laurie Fleet with the Office of Water. With me today is Hollis Henley with the Environmental Law Division. The rulemaking would repeal Chapter 321, subchapters E, F, and L, and Chapter 351, subchapter D, which were determined to be obsolete during the 2019 quadrennial rule reviews. The proposed rulemaking was published in the Texas Register in October of 2021, and the comment period ended in November of 2021. No public comments were received. Staff respectfully request adoption of the proposed rule and authorization to make non-substantive changes to comply with Texas Register requirements. Thank you, and we're available for questions.
Thank you again, Ms. Fleet. I have none. Commissioner Lindley. Commissioner Janeka.
No questions. Thanks for getting us in on the wire.
Correct. No one signed
in. Mr. McWhirter.
OPIC recommends adoption of the rulemaking to delete obsolete subchapters of Chapter 321 and Chapter 351 identified in the 2019 quad review as presented by the ED.
I agree, and I sincerely hope that Sunset staff has tuned in to watch this. This is good stuff, cleaning out the dead wood.
That is.
I think we're ready for a motion.
I'll gladly give it. I move that we adopt the repeal of 30 Texas Administrative Code, Chapter 321, subchapters E, F, and L, and Chapter 351, subchapter D, as recommended by the Executive Director.
I second.
The motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
The motion carries. Thank you, Ms. Fleet. Ms. Smith, please call the next item.
Item 24 is the consideration of the adoption of amendments to 30 Texas Administrative Code Chapter 114 to implement Senate Bill 604. The Executive Director's staff is here to present the item.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Commissioners, General Counsel, and Public Interest Counsel. On behalf of the Executive Director, I am Nicholas Landit with the Air Quality Division, and with me is Sierra Redding of the Environmental Law Division. This adopted rulemaking would implement the revisions to Texas Transportation Code Chapter 504, required by Senate Bill 604, 86 Texas Legislature, by removing the requirement that the vehicle registration insignia sticker be affixed to the vehicle windshield and adding language to allow for different forms of compliance. Thank you, and we are available to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Landit. I have none. Commissioner Lindley, any questions?
I was just going to ask, is this your first agenda?
It is, yes.
Flawless.
Welcome. Quite a welcome.
Flawless.
Yes.
Yeah.
Pick the straightforward and compact rulemakings. Good job. No questions here. Thank you.
And no one has signed in, have they?
That's correct.
Okay. Mr. McWhirter.
OPIC recommends adoption of the proposed amendments to the Commission's Chapter 114 rules to implement provisions of Senate Bill 604 as presented by the Executive Director.
I agree. Straightforward legislative implementation. No comments. I'm ready to move forward.
Me too. I would move that we adopt the amendments to 30 Texas Administrative Code Chapter 114 as recommended by the Executive Director.
I second the motion.
The motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. The motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Smith, please call the next items.
The next items, 25 through 28, are for executive session. The Commission will meet in executive session in Building E, Room 211S. Do you want to, in 5 minutes or?
5 minutes.
Okay. In 5 minutes. As permitted by the Open Meetings Act, including Texas Government Code Sections 551.071 and 551.074, to take up and consider matters pursuant to items number 25 through 28 as posted and noticed.
With that, the time is 12:48 p.m. and we stand in recess.
The commission met in room 211S in building E for closed session from 12:54 a.m. until 1:05 a.m. on items 27 and 28 as posted and noticed pursuant to Texas Government Code Section 551.074. No action was taken. The agenda stands adjourned and the time is 1:08.